Coming to you live from my apartment, it's Rob Has a Podcast. And now here's the guy who only wishes that Clowny could be the one that was unforgettable. Rob Sestradino, hello everybody, and welcome back to our special live edition of Big Brother Podcast here. And we are live after the Sunday night edition of Big Brother 15. And we have a tremendously special guest with us here today. We have we spoke to her last season, and it was so much fun, and she's good enough to come back and join us this summer to talk about Big Brother 15. Here she is from Big Brother 13. It's Shelley Moore.
Hey, how are y'all?
Yes, and we wanted more Shelley, and here she is.
I got the name for it, right?
Yes, perfect. And Shelley, I know how badly you would have liked to have discussed Aaron being evicted this week, but unfortunately we're going to talk about Aaron being the head of household.
I know. Big Brother karma, it always happens that way.
Yes, that's how it always happens. And then this is how this always happens. We have our live feed expert here with us on the line, Mr. Brian Lynch. Brian, how are you doing?
I'm doing well. It's good to see both of y'all.
Yes, good.
To see you.
Yeah, and Brian, did you get a haircut?
Yeah, I got a haircut about a week ago.
Wow, looking sharp, looking very sharp tonight, Brian. All right.
Thank you very much.
So we are here live on Rob's website and on our YouTube channel. We hit a big milestone this week on the YouTube channel. We passed 7,000 subscribers on our YouTube channel. So thanks to all of you guys who are watching the show and subscribing on our YouTube. If you want to get in on this, you can go to robhasawebsite.com/YouTube and go there and subscribe anytime. And just one other note before we jump into this, our Whodunit podcast, if you're waiting for that tonight, that's going to be delayed by one day. So I will have that up for you on Tuesday morning rather than Monday morning. I'm actually going to go, Shelley, get this, the Big Brother Canada people are in town this week, and I'm going to be going to a Big Brother reunion, I guess. I don't know what.
Oh, good.
Yes.
That's great.
I will be visiting with some Big Brother people, and hopefully trying to find some more guests for Rob as a Podcast.
They'll be knocking down your door.
No.
You're going to get a whole bunch of new subscribers tonight. I have to do this, but on the live feeds, and Brian, you probably know this, but I hang out in the BB Strategic Talk Room. It's the best room on the live chats. We talk probably every night, every day, and just a great group of people. It's fun to get in there and really talk to the real fans, and they were all going to come listen to you tonight. So shout out to the BB Strategic Talk Room. They're just fantastic.
Yeah, so that's
Ian comes there, and a bunch of people come there all the time. It makes it a lot of fun. Those are the real fans.
Yeah, so that's on the live feeds. There's a special Strategic Talk chat room, and you go there and interact with the fans. That's great, Shelley.
Yeah, no, they're a lot of fun. It makes it fun to see how they see the game.
Yeah. All right, well, and I'm sure that they are thrilled when you come in and hang out, just like we're thrilled to have you here.
Oh, thank you.
Yes. All right, well, Shelley, let's get into this. And I know we've been emailing for a couple of weeks now about this, and you've been saying from the get-go you do not like the Aaron. Now she is the new woman in charge of the Big Brother house, or at least is just a figurehead of the woman in charge of the Big Brother house.
Yeah, but no kidding.
Aaron, in the broad strokes, have you ever seen anything like this before in your Big Brother watching history of Aaron?
No, Aaron kind of falls into a category all by herself. You know, it's interesting to watch her because the more I watch her, the more I realize that she's probably just very young, inexperienced, hasn't learned a whole lot of things that you think a child, a girl, a woman at that age would know. And I think a lot of it boils down to the fact that she has spent a lot of time in her life worrying about from this part out instead of what falls in here.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that some of the things she says come out now as very rude and aggressive and not very nice. And I think what she said is deplorable. It's kind of taught me a lot of things because I thought we were way past that.
Mm-hmm.
So when it started happening, I was shocked. But it's hilarious to watch her over the last couple of days because she's cleaning the kitchen. She's picking up towels. You know, you just wonder if anybody, little bird from the outside, has said, you better clean up your act. Because,
yeah.
You know, she's just, it's like this 180-degree turn. You know, she says she's going to muzzle herself, then she doesn't muzzle herself. Of all the people, I never thought she would keep her deal in nominations tonight. I certainly didn't think, really, I would have kept Caitlin, thinking that she was more malleable, more pliable. You could probably keep her and get her to go with you easier. Erin was a little more stubborn, and she's actually letting Helen and Amanda run her HOH, which, you know, blows my mind. But, you know, the real payday comes after you get out of the Big Brother house. I can speak from experience. And hopefully she has two ears and one mouth and listens and reads and learns and comes out of it a better person. I don't want the girl to be hated or threatened or her life ruined. She's so young, but she's got a lot to learn, and I hope she learns it. She's going to learn some of it the hard way. But if they don't get her out before jury, we're never going to see any of the Julie questions, which will be the highest rated show ever.
Yeah, it would be good. So a bunch of interesting stuff that you said there. One thing about Aaron's youth. Now, do you feel like it's an advantage to go into the Big Brother house and like to not be basically the oldest people they put in the Big Brother house are like people like in their 30s. But is that a big advantage going in the Big Brother house to have like all this life experience of somebody who's not being who's not 22 years old? Do you feel like that's does that help you in the game?
I think it cuts both ways. For Erin, she's going to get out and people are going to say she's young and hasn't made those mistakes yet to learn. When you go in, you're older, be it an Amanda, a Helen, myself, and you hide a dog or do stupid things, people say you're a mom. You should know better. You're 40.
Mm-hmm.
So that can cut both ways. I mean, I think a lot of the things that went on so far this season are things that are kind of taught at home or learned. I think in a way they think they're trying to be funny. And everybody has a different sense of humor. On Big Brother, you can offend people by just trying to be funny, and you can offend people by truly being offensive. It all matters what the audience is. You know, it's a game, so people say, hey, you know, they're just trying to fit in. They're trying to do the things they do. But the bottom line is there are some things in life that are just better left unsaid or at least not said in the forum that they're saying because they're just flat wrong. So as a mom going in there, I got crucified, rightly so, for some of the immature things I did because I was 40.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Amanda's a little bit older, and she's doing some things in there that I don't think somebody her age should be doing either. So, you know, it is great entertainment. I got to give her that. But sometimes you wonder if they sit there and think after all the seasons that they've seen. I don't think a lot of these kids have seen very much Big Brother.
Yeah.
I think they've seen a season or two and don't. When they don't understand that there's flashback and there's feeds and the people that are the fans of the show will screenshot and go back and watch everything, I don't think they all completely know what they get into. But you definitely expect more out of an adult. Erin's going to come out with that advantage that she's younger and people give her a chance that she has all those years to yet fix it and learn. You know, if I went in and did things like that, which I don't even think that's a part of me, but I also didn't think I'd hide somebody's dog. So in the house, things different do happen.
Yeah.
And it's just really, a lot of people have said coming out that the pressure in there is very different and you do get frustrated and you act a totally different way. And I think when Erin comes out and she actually physically has to look at what she did, she's going to feel horrible. And I hope that she just does the right things going about it. She's got to own it. And she's got to truly make a change. And I hope that she handles it, not necessarily publicly, but privately, goes back to the people that she hurt. Because what I noticed is I don't think Helen still realizes that she has said anything about her. So Helen is like feeding Erin, we're going to protect you, we're going to protect you. I don't think even that Helen realizes the full scope of it at this point.
Yeah, I doubt she realizes the full scope. I remember that at least at one conversation where Howard was sort of telling her about some of the things that she had been saying. So I think she knows some of it, and kudos to Helen for being able to keep her eye on the prize and not get caught up in it. But I think you're right that for whoever is advising Erin when she gets out of the house, she needs to own, you know, the things that she said and say, oh, you know, people, what I said wasn't even that bad. How could people say that?
And that will be the wrong way to go about it.
Go.
I mean, very much. I mean, even Caitlin, watching her, she's trying to put it all on Erin.
Mm-hmm.
And you see her saying, well, gosh, I got a scapegoat over here. I can dump it on her. And I'm even seeing over the past couple days that she's trying to own up a little bit. So either you mean it that you apologize or you don't. If you don't mean it, don't say it. Just go on with your life and be who you're going to be. And people will choose to like you for that or not like you for that. But and then you get away from that whole issue and say, it's not a personal game. You can't play the game as personal. And if the game had been personal, all the times they've tried to get Aaron out, be it by America or by their own doing, it's not happening. So you might as well see what she can do. And who knows? I mean, I just pray that that woman does not make it to the end, because could you imagine trying to turn a check over to that girl at the end?
Yeah.
Oh, Lord. Could that would just be awful for everybody involved. So hopefully somebody gets their stuff together and realizes she needs to hit the road soon.
All right, well, a couple more just big picture things before we get into tonight's episode. You played in your season with returning players come back. You had newbies, and then you had returning players coming back in pairs. This season, we have all new players with the exception, all new players, but we have one person who's not like everybody else in Rachel's sister. Now, you've famously played with Brendan and Rachel. Did you ever meet Rachel's sister before this season?
I did. I met her at their wedding.
Ooh.
And my husband got to spend a lot of time with her in the green room when I was voting for her to win. So
yeah.
He was not a bit surprised when she was cast. That was hilarious. And his first thing was, oh my gosh, what are they doing? You know. But she is a very sweet girl. The times I've met her, she's very sweet. And she's losing it, I think, on the show a little bit. I'm not sure what's going on there. I mean, anybody that looks at her, I'll tell you what, I'd kill for her body. She's a gorgeous, I mean, I'm signing up for yoga if it does that to you. I mean, sign me up. I'll take hoagie yatties, lagalotties. I don't even know half the things, but if I can do a couple of those poses, I'm going to have one happy hubby at home.
Yeah.
But she's she just is not the same player as Rachel. I mean, the strategy, I don't know what it is. And for her, I can honestly say I appreciate that she wants to be this good and loving and very kind person, and that's fantastic, but that is not going to work in that house.
Mm-hmm.
You cannot go and judge and judge and judge. It just doesn't work. You either have to get over the personal vendetta and move on, or it'll be your downfall. So, and she does talk. I mean, I'm shocked when people go and tell her things now, because really they all go blab. I don't know anybody that keeps their mouth shut. Every time you say something, Helen is like, okay, now don't tell. Don't tell. Don't tell. Okay, don't tell. I won't. I won't. I promise. It's just between you and me. It's just between you and me. The second they walk away from each other, it's like, and they are off to the races. And the story becomes bigger and better each time you tell people, and it gets a little more added to it each time. But, I mean, sometimes I think Alyssa's really smart about what she's saying, like when she went out to Caitlin, you know, to try to say, hey, so-and-so's, you know, and then Aaron's like, well, you know, you're talking my name, and you're talking about me, and, you know, she wasn't necessarily talking about her, but she was talking around her to get her fire lit a little bit. So in some of those things, I think it's pretty smart, but the strategy is really hard to follow in there.
Mm-hmm.
It's really hard. It's just everybody talks all the time, and I was a talker. I mean, I got information from both sides, but I kept going back to the same people. These guys tell anybody that they think. I mean, I think if somebody comes to Helen and says, Andy wants you out, she would have him up on the block as fast as she can against everybody else, because anytime they say her name, she wants him up.
Yeah,
and none of them realize that Amanda and McCray sitting behind Amanda are running the entire house, and Helen's the mouthpiece of them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It blows my mind.
All right, well, let's get into some of this strategy going on in the house. And we had a lot of the episode focused on Aaron's HOH and this deal that she made with Helen.
Yep.
And Shelley, call me crazy. I think Aaron is playing particularly well right now.
So do I. It makes me awful. You have to give her a little bit of props. You really do. If you're looking solely at game, she's figured out how to be nice, play nice, and get back in people's good graces to get into the number side. And if she had gone up and blown up, I wish she would have blown up nominations and done something totally different. It would have given us more to talk about because this is very much what is expected. But, yeah, she has. You got to give her credit. If she wants to stay in the game, she's playing that part much better right now.
Because this deal she made with Helen is like the best thing she could have ever done. She gets yep. the HOH, she gets the safety, and basically she's sort of like going around like, oh, my hands are tied. I gave away my nominations. Like, you're like, can't. I want to help you, Howard. I want to help you, Spencer, but I just exactly. have to do what Helen wants. And she's, you know, she holds my life in her hands, and I have to do what she wants. And Helen, I'm doing exactly what you want, see? And so she's really in like this wonderful position where she's able to completely, like, where it looked like you would have bet anything she was out of the game on Thursday, she's able to sort of nosedive, and she's back in a pretty good spot.
I mean, she ought to bet on 36 with a heavy ball every day of the week, because that little drop ball, I mean, that's one of those luck challenges that anybody could have got, and she's gone in and put the target bigger on Helen now, mm-hmm. bigger on everybody else, and her hands are just like this. And she is just scot-free, and they will probably carry her a couple more weeks because she's playing nice. I mean, she's cleaning the kitchen and making fried rice in the house now.
Whoa.
It blows you away what she's doing now. It's totally the opposite of everything else she was doing. Brian, if you've been watching, you're probably saying the same thing, like, oh, my gosh, what is going on?
Brian, you know, are you amazed by Alyssa, Aaron's transformation?
Yeah, Aaron's definitely turned a new leaf since Caitlin's eviction.
Okay.
Yeah, we'll just see what happens. Yeah, we'll see what happens with that leaf as the week goes, you know?
Yeah. And how's
is it a poisonous leaf? Is it an apple under that leaf? Is, you know, I think it's beyond her to keep it all under control very much longer. Because it's easy to be in control when you're in power. I mean, that's the one thing in the house. If you can get power, which I could never get power, so I could never make a decision or keep the control on my... She has control, so everybody sucks up, and this is a really sucky, uppy bunch of people when you're in HOH. My heavens. I mean, they really do. They're up there. I mean, it's even funny. Spencer's not even in the in crowd, and he sits up there, and it's just kind of like, wow. You know, they suck up really well.
Yeah. How's about this for the icing on the cake for Aaron? So then, I guess... Aaron tells Jesse about the deal that she had, and I guess Jesse told Candace about the deal, and so Candace confronts Helen, and Helen assumes that Alyssa is the one who blabbed about the deal, and Helen is saying, okay, next we got to get Alyssa out of the game.
Yeah, man, so, she turned on her quick, didn't she?
Yeah.
Turned on her, that big old bus was coming down the road, and she just chucked her out in the middle of the road, but their game of telephone is so flawed that... They have the thing for the Helens and the Andes and those people is they have scapegoats. They can always throw it on Alyssa. They can always throw it on Aaron. They always have somebody right now in front of them to throw it on. And that's how they're going to play, is they're going to figure out who they can throw under the bus, who they can blame. They have been trying to figure out who to blame since the first vote they ever took. The moving company tried to put votes out there and said, okay, we'll get Candace to take the blame for that. For some reason this year, everybody's trying to figure out where this vote is that they can ditch on somebody. And it's a blame game. It's a totally different game than I've ever seen.
Now, do you think it's because they started with such a large number of house guests that there was like so many votes that you could really... But it was 9-4. Who was the 4? Who was
right.
the 9?
And the MVP has thrown a big old wrench in it. You know, I thought it would be kind of neat how to do that, because with three people up, there's less room to hide. You're not going to have any floaters. Well, it hasn't. I don't know that it served that purpose at all. I think it's all it has done is forced them to play faster, more ridiculous, run around in circles. I mean, they're putting powers in the house that aren't even close to being in there yet, if they ever got them. Right now, they're at the amount of people that most seasons start with, and they're talking about jury.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they're already talking about who's going to make jury and who deserves it. I love the talk about, do you deserve it? You don't deserve to be here. You don't. I'm like, do any of you guys deserve to? I think that's so funny when they say it. You know, you hear them outside talking. Yeah, he doesn't deserve to be on jury. I just want to knock on the screen and go, jury folks, if you're in jury, you're a loser. You've lost. Nobody wants to be there.
Yeah.
But they're all happy to get it, and that's the other thing about being young. The way they look at it is they figure, hey, I get paid if I go to jury.
Yeah.
It's free money.
I get 5 more weeks of vacation. I don't have to go
home. I get 5 more weeks of vacay and watching girls in bikinis for Spencer. I mean, that I won't even go into what I think of that guy. I get a creepy feeling when I see him on the screen.
All right, so...
Sorry.
No, we'll talk more about Spencer in a little bit here. So Aaron is the HOH, and we were worried about this on Thursday. You know what that means, Shelley. It's the return of Clowny.
That thing's terrible.
Yeah.
And they leave him on screens on the live feed at night. So if you're like me and you go to sleep with your live feeds on and you wake up and there's that clown in that green light, and you're like, ah, it's either that or... This morning, honestly, I got awakened by McCray and McManda. You know, it was 6 o'clock in the morning, and I hear slurpy derpy, and I was like, whoa. I wake up, and I'm like, no. Too early for this stuff. And then there's that clown.
Yeah.
So don't sleep with your feeds on.
Well, you're used to all these showmances. I mean, you played on a season with Brendan and Rachel and Jeff and Jordan and Danny and Dominico, but they weren't, they had the decency to wait until they got out of the house to be.
And so did Jeff and Jordan. They were very classy about it. And,
yeah.
And so, yeah, these people, they all must have taken, I don't know, some kind of horn dog test before they came in here because they rate off the charts. There's a whole bunch of showmancing going on. They're young and in love. What can you say? I always think there's going to be a little Wiz Khalifa playing in the background, huh?
Yeah. How funny was Amanda with Clowny in the diary room tonight?
That was really good. It was really cute. I thought that was funny. She's great for that entertainment. She really is. She's good at it. It's second nature to her. She's very entertaining in the diary room.
Yeah, she's fantastic.
I enjoy that. I think it's neat.
Yeah. And... also in the whole, we had the old hide and go seek on the HOH. That's always a crowd pleaser.
That was good. I thought that, at first when I saw that, I was like, oh my gosh, where are they? You know, people aren't, and I didn't realize that they had hidden. But that was great. Yeah, that was fun, and it makes it fun. And
did you guys do that in your season? I feel like did you guys do it to Rachel?
We did a pillow. We all hid with pillows when she came out and launched the pillows at her. So, yeah, that was nice, and that was fun. And that clown being in there again was that thing is – that'll go down in infamy. That and the bear shirt, I think, that'll be talked about forever.
Yeah. So in the midst of all of the fun and games in Aaron's HOH room, Aaron catches herself because she said axed instead of asked. And she blames that on Candace. She's, oh, my God, I'm hanging out with you too much. I just said axe.
Where if you do that you just keep going. I mean, I don't even know. And she kept going back to it and saying it again.
Yeah.
And when the lights are already on you, it's going to shine brighter. Nobody's going to miss any of that now. So the light, it just gets brighter and brighter and brighter. And the guilty sign gets bigger and bigger and bigger. And that... As soon as I heard that, I was like, oh, my gosh, that'll be the thing. I mean, that was just – she blamed it on her. I mean, she should have just said she misspoke. I mean, that's just young.
Yeah.
Just doesn't get it.
She's just like, oh, my God, I said axed, and I get that from you because you say that all the time.
And then Howard's face is just like, you know. I'm sure that they will – he talks. I laugh when he does talk because he's very good at calming her down, Candace.
Yeah.
But I when I try to follow him talking, I don't follow what he is doing. He talks in circles. He's such a sweet man and a kind man and just takes such good care of himself and everything. I can't follow what he's doing at all.
Yeah. So then after we had the HOH room, we had an extended McCray and Amanda in the bath. Shelley, I know you can't get enough of them on the live feeds. Did you need to see McCray and Amanda in the bath tonight?
No, I really don't. I really don't. I'm like, but I can tell you, I'm sure all the people that love their little showmance and they're making McBabies and McGrandas and all that. That's all great. I think it's totally different for a mom, because I think for her mom going, oh my gosh, her mom's got to be mortified, her father. You know, I worry about them because half the people probably think it's great and half don't. So in my head, I'm like, oh Lord, what are you doing? You know, it was kind of cute at the end when he, I don't know, made some bubbles in the tub.
I didn't know it was a jacuzzi in the HOH.
Yeah, no kidding. You know, that was, it was cute how they did it. But sometimes when she talks to him, it creeps me out because I feel like it's a mother, like she mothers him, like talking to her son, like, oh. And she's always like grooming him in that, what's that, what I always call it, the fortune teller room. But whenever they're in there, she's always like fixing his hair, asking him if he's going to change his shirt. And sometimes I'm like, you act like you're his mom.
Yeah.
You know, no man wants a nag, period. I don't care anyway. The one quality I think no man wants is a naggy woman to tell him what to do.
I don't think McCray's complaining too much, Shelley.
I think he's a very happy man. I really do. I mean, and honestly, I think it's for real. I think they really do like each other a lot.
Yeah.
So, and if he doesn't, that's awful for her, but he has put a huge target in front of him.
Yeah.
And she is doing the heavy lifting. And she is taking the heat, and, you know, America was really pro-Amanda. Now, you know, it's funny. I saw something on one of the websites. I thought it was brilliant, but they always say, you know, Amanda's stock is falling, sell, 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 or Judd's stock is falling, sell, 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 because people get so high on somebody, and then you see them do something, and they go the other way.
Mm-hmm.
And you can turn on a house guest this fast. I mean, people will love you one minute, the next minute if you do something to one of that, you're awful, and it can go sadly the other way.
Yes.
Very quickly.
Yes. Yes, you seem like you know about that show.
I know so much about it, so it's fun because it's a lot more fun watching it on this side of the TV than the other side of the TV.
Yeah. So, and I forgot to mention at the top of the show, this is live and interactive, and we are going to be taking your questions about Big Brother and about everything going on in the house, and your questions for Shelley in a little bit. So if you want to get your questions in, Jessica Frey is behind the scenes. She's in the chat room. She is watching on the YouTube video. If you post your questions on the YouTube video itself, we can take them and put them on the screen, or if you use the hashtag RHAP over on Twitter, and so we're just going to keep going along here, and then later on we'll get into the live feeds and everything that happened after the nominations with Brian, so a lot still coming up here on this show. So Spencer and Howard both went about making their pitches to Aaron in different ways. So Spencer took the direct approach, and he went to go talk to Aaron, and what did you think about Spencer's pitch to try to save himself from going up on the block?
He was direct, but none of them turn over their directness to say, okay, this is why I want to stay and here's what we can do. All he said is, hey, I think you can get more numbers if you go like this.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you got to put it out in front of her. I mean, you got to understand that she, in her mind, has these people that have saved her and are going to keep her in the house. So if you don't give her a very good pitch on why she should come over to you and not put, but especially when she's got all this backup, you know, she's got 14 people in her spine saying, you can do it. They're holding her up. So you've got to try to turn it the other way. So I think his pitches are always such a soft sell, and he's kind of just like this, that it just doesn't come across as good or genuine or even worth it. He just doesn't strike me as a player. And what's interesting is when he first, off of his video, when I first watched him, I thought his personality would really shine, that he would be somebody that, you know, had some game. And I just, he doesn't seem to have game at all. And, you know, he seems to work Jesse, and you feel like he would go through her and try. She's very malleable. You could mold her wherever you want her to go and keep Judd close. But I don't think either one of their pitches were very good, and I think that's why they're both up there. And you've got to somehow figure out how to get a group and get that group to go together. But when you have a bunch of sheep, you know, they're going to all follow their little shepherd, and they know who that is right now. Nobody will go over here and ring a bell and say, hey, come over here. I got better food or I got a better opportunity. They just won't do it because they're all playing for safety right now.
So, Shelly, how do you walk that fine line between, let's say you're Spencer and you're worried about going up on the block. Like, how do you go up there and talk to the HOH and say, here's what I wanted, like, here's my plan, here's what I think we should do, and here's whom I think we should target, and not have the HOH turn around and go tell that person that you said that I want to go target you?
Yeah, that's the hard part. And I think you have to handle that from both sides. I think you can go to Aaron and say, hey, listen, this is what we're doing. You've got to think about the fact that if you continue to have... Alyssa's been the widowmaker. She has broken up all the couples, okay? She's broken up all the pairs. Now, you have to go in there with this pitch and say, listen, everybody's playing on their own now except for two people. They're playing together. And if we don't find a way to at least break them up, listen, I know you're close with both of them and you'll still have one, but now you've gained me in this posse of people. But you've got to think past it a little bit. You've got to think about how we go forward. You break them up, and now you gain this other six people. But you have to understand, Aaron, and you got to tell her, Aaron, they have all said you can believe them or not, but they're going to dump you the first second they can get to dump you. Amanda and McCray will never turn on each other. Andy and Helen are not going to turn on each other. Alyssa will follow Helen. And you have to show her that Gina's not going to help you. She's alone out here. So why don't we pull our posse together and go over here and make it happen? And I think you have to approach it from both sides. And I think in some ways you've got to find somebody on the other side to go with you that if you make a threat to her to say, if you go talk and you know who she's talking to, if you go and on the backside get them to fall in with you to say, you know, I'm going to go tell Shelly that you said that, or I'm going to go tell whoever that you said that, that threat works a little bit better. At this point, with how scared they are about a coup d'etat, I would fake that I had it if I was that desperate as them. I would say, listen, I have a power, and if you don't talk about it, I get to share it with one other person, but you've got to keep your mouth shut. If you talk, you're out, and I promise you, you're out. And what? I would, as much as they're all talking about it and stressed about it, I would do it. If I knew my butt was on the block like it was, I mean, that's where things like pulling rings out of your pocket and that you just got to figure any way possible, but they have to understand what makes her tick. I mean, if you tell her, I will get you a bottle of hair dye, she might look at it. You know, if I get you new extensions, I mean, you got to find what, and I'm being kind of facetious there, but they got to figure out what makes Aaron tick, and what makes Aaron tick is making her feel like, Aaron, you really are a good person. Aaron, everybody kind of sees you wrong, and I want to help people see you right. So show people that you can keep a secret. Show people that you can play this game. Let's get together and go do it. And nobody will expect that you and I are working together, Spencer and Aaron. You know, and I think if it may never work. I mean, sometimes they don't, but you got to go in and do more than, well, I just wanted you to hear my story, and, you know, I think we can do this. That's not going to get you anywhere. You got to, if you don't want to go home, you got to make big moves. And right now they're all so skittish that you could make up any lie and probably stay. But you got to be willing to lie. And I obviously was.
Oh, Shelly, you're putting on like a master's class tonight.
No, not at all. Fantastic. Not at all. Go in those strategy rooms, and those people have awesome ideas. I mean, I wish all those people would go out BB strategy room and stuff, and they would try out for Big Brother because they really think through the game. I'm sure, Brian, you get it. When you watch some of the chat, they really get the game, and they follow everything. I mean, watching people follow Judd's strategy. Some people think Judd doesn't know what he's doing. Judd is really good about what he puts out there and what he doesn't put out there. Very good social. And he's kind of got an out because he agrees to what everybody says. His strategy is agree, agree, agree. And then he can back out of it whenever he wants. But he's very good at putting out the information that he wants. And I think McCray may be the only one figuring out that he's pretty smart. But I love that kid. I think he is just a doll, baby. I do. I think he's funny.
Okay. And you would you wear a bear shirt like Judd has?
Absolutely, I would in a heartbeat. In a heartbeat. He's a doll. I just like, you know why I think he's so genuine, and at times I don't even know if he realizes he's as good as he is. I think it's very just, It's very just him. I mean, the way that he talks to people is really cute. I just think he's a neat young man.
So we also had our have-have-not competition for tonight. I thought it was kind of a boring have-have-not. It was a rather forgettable have-have-not, ironically.
Yeah.
Where we had basically, we combined my least favorite thing, the have-have-not competition, with some product placement for the new season of Unforgettable.
Yep. Coming
CBS next week.
That's
so,
right.
I bet it was a hard game also to remember where you put all those things, right?
Well, I mean, anybody that goes in there to do that game, they're all grabbing it as quick as they can. Nobody stays there and looks at it. And now the next guests that go into the house next season, when they have a challenge like that, somebody will be sitting there memorizing the shelf, and they'll mess it up for you again. You know, you don't think about that way. I thought it was really funny how the different groups approached the challenge.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if it was editing or what, but it looked like some of them just like went one by one by one to grab things and throw it on the table, and the rest of them brought it all over and stacked it up, which was pretty smart, so you could see the sizes and everything. But, hey, the outfits were cute. But and it was funny to watch. I got to give Gina Marie credit. She is good funny on TV with her just, I got to do my blonde thing now, and she had no clue. I mean, I think it's funny. I mean, I think her, the I don't even know if you call it vocabulary that she uses, but it cracks me up. There are times that I laugh out loud when I hear that girl talk. She's just so goofy.
Her compromisation.
Compromisation and just all the little words she makes up, and then watching her put down yogurt. I've never seen anything like that in my entire life.
No, never. Ever. Nobody has.
And she, if you weren't a live feeder, go online. You can watch her do a cinnamon challenge. Never in my life have I seen anything like that.
What's the cinnamon challenge?
They went and had, they did it in our season too. Brendan and Rachel put cinnamon in their mouth, and you put a teaspoon in, and you can't swallow it. And like Brendan looked like Puff the Magic Dragon. It was so cute. But it goes up in your nose, and they're spitting and throwing up, and it's gross. Well, so Judd and Aaron decided to do it outside, and they put it in, and they were spitting, and it was, I mean, Aaron started choking and gagging right away, Judd too. Well, then Gina, of course, in her kind of tough way, said, bring it, okay, bro? So she takes this big old teaspoon of cinnamon, pops it in her mouth. Now, nobody goes more than about 10 seconds, and it's flying out, and she goes, bring it! And she gets it down. I've never seen anybody get it down. So
and
then
she did it twice.
Did it again.
Whoa.
And then she wanted to do the milk challenge, and I was like, that girl, there's just something different going on with her whole throat, nose, swallowing. I don't know how she did it, because you can go watch that online, Cinnamon Challenge, and nobody gets it down, and she killed it. It was amazing.
All right.
And it's just funny. She has that tough. It really Brooklyn tough, but I'm sure all the pageant people were like, oh, my Lord, that's our pageant girl. I'm sure they've said that several times, and I don't even know what pageant girls do, but I can only see that their pageant poor people are probably like, that's our girl.
Hey, you know, look, what's the big deal? I got to eat some cinnamon. That's what I do for my special talent in the beauty competition. I eat cinnamon. I eat anything.
You do a great accent. That accent is so funny, and the way that she does it is always like, you know, people would always tease me. When I went back and watched the feeds, people would always say, oh, just awful things about, but I mean, she talk about talking like a man. She's like, oh, yeah, dope, bro, hip, hop, 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 popping things and scrapping things. And I'm like, wow. But the accent that you do, it is funny when she does that. And just, I will never forget the cockroaches. And then one time she said something, I was laughing so hard. She's like, let's blow this popsicle stand or something. And I'm like, wait, don't you want to stay? Why are you saying you want to get out? You know, she's like, yeah, but that's when she got really mad. And she's like, blow this popsicle stand. I'm like, no, you want to stay.
Yeah.
But she doesn't know how to place her little, it's kind of funny, but there is an endearing part of her too. Her mouth is just filthy. Filthy.
Yes.
Drinking games online for the language that they use. They always, our strategy room, they do drinking games all the time, where if they say like or don't tell anybody or the not so nice word. So it's funny to watch people do that, because it lets you enjoy the show.
So after Have Not, we had a very interesting part of the show. I think maybe the most interesting part of the entire episode was the Howard and Candace stuff, because I was a little confused about what Howard actually wanted. So he sets up Candace. He tells Candace that she needs to go talk to Aaron. And he says basically, as you mentioned earlier, one of his speeches, a little circular perhaps, that he says to Candace, he's like, and he's very soft-spoken. He's like, you know when I told you that you had to go and hold back? He's like, now's the time. You need to go get your bed back. And I'm like, okay.
I didn't get that.
Yeah, go get your bed back. And so he sends in Candace to go talk to Aaron, and Aaron says she has a Candace switch, which allows her to just block her out. And Candace comes back dejected and very upset with Howard, feeling like that Howard set her up to be a target here. And so it's a two-part question here. Number one, what was Howard's agenda? What did he want? And is Candace right to feel this way?
I'm with you. I have no idea what he wants, and I didn't understand it. And I think it was some really, like, positive attitude speech, like, go get your bed back, go take back your name, go get it, and go get it from Aaron. And at the same time, where it seemed like back and all that, he didn't want her to suck up to her. It seemed like now he was asking her to suck up to somebody that had hurt her. And she wanted to do it for him, because she obviously cares about him, and she went up there and did it and got nothing in return. Absolutely. And honestly, in watching that exchange, you knew that Candace was obviously putting a bigger target on her back, that Aaron was coming out of it going, you know what, you both can go. And so I think she came down dejected because she didn't get this real positive reaction from Aaron, like, I really do want Howard to stay. I think it was very contrived, and she felt it. And I think still, Candace says she forgives and she forgets. I still think it's very difficult for her to go and talk face-to-face with her. I don't think she likes her. And I think she felt like Howard was putting her up there to do his game. And if he wanted to go make his speech to save himself, he needs to go do it himself. You know, it was probably, I can understand as women, we're emotional. Men are typically more visual. And I think he thought that she could go in there and make the emotional plea better than him. And so he maybe used her a little bit to get to that side. And she came back, and his first thing to her was, you know, how'd it go? Not, how are you doing? Mm-hmm. And a woman is more emotional. I think she was hurt by that. So it was odd. It was an odd ending. And I'm not sure where that story's going. I wonder if that story will peel into Wednesday, because it was a little bit confusing to me of where all of that is going, except for, you know, the nominations.
Brian, did you have a better read on that Candace, Howard, and Aaron discussion?
You know, I was left with the impression that he may have, you know, since it benefits him, that he may have wanted her to do that, but might not want to say it on the feeds or even express it in the diary room. But, you know, who knows? I mean, maybe he thought that that was actually a good idea, but it obviously wasn't. If he wanted to do something, maybe going, getting her to go to Alyssa or to Amanda to get into Aaron's ear instead of just going straight to Aaron, I thought might work better.
Yeah, Brian, that's a great point. Really is.
Yeah. So do you think that Howard has played a good game to this point? I mean, he is. It seems to be that he's really got the Amanda McCray group coming after him pretty hard at this point. Do you like Howard's game so far?
Not really. I like Howard. I think he's a neat guy. But he's letting everybody walk on him. He doesn't – his talking and his engage – I don't – he's got like a super Spider-Man type mentality. Like he can be back and wear his clothes and his cape and everything, and at some point he's going to all of a sudden – everyone thinks he's going to bust open his shirt and he's going to be a comp beast. I mean – I don't think he's throwing competitions, number one. I don't think he's very good at competitions. I think he is has tried to play this game at the beginning that he was very under the radar and very much a come to me game. If they want to talk to me, they'll come to me. It doesn't, you've got to endear yourself to people to be able to get in a group. And I just don't think he's doing that. I think he separates himself from the group quite a bit. Watch him. He never eats with anybody else. He always goes and sits at the table alone to eat. In the beginning, obviously for his own choice, he was going and praying and doing, and that's fine. I think as with anything in the house, if you come in real big, anything religion, and people start telling you to swear on your Bible, it never works well. They think you're shady because you're going to lie in the house. Mm-hmm. So, and then when people force you to do that, it just gets out of control too quick. So I don't think he knew how he was going to play, and then I think when he got in there, the game got a little bit over his head. I think he is a very kind guy. Sometimes kind only seems to work for the Jeffs and Jordans of the world. Sometimes kind doesn't work for other people. And you really do have to be a very special person to get through this game, being kind and being liked through the whole thing. It's hard, and he's a beast. I don't even know if there was an endurance competition because he's so big, like a Jesse or those guys. I don't think he could stay on very long anyway because he's so muscular. So, and obviously in the water challenge, he hated that challenge. He didn't like that one. And the one he threw with Aaron, dumping the stuff on her face, I thought he won that. He won the hearts of all of us in that one. I got to tell you, he won in my book on that one.
Yeah,
I thought it was hilarious.
All right, well, we've got so much to get to from the live feeds over the weekend. So for you non-spoiler people, all right, this is the point you're going to want to check out and then come back and listen to the rest of this if you're interested on Wednesday after the episode. And now I will now open up the floor to discuss everything that has happened since since the nominations. It's spoiler time.
Oh.
All right. We're free to discuss everything now at this point.
The chicken fried rice up too early.
No, that's fine.
I'm sorry.
Fine. So, Brian, at this hour, we have America's has nominated somebody to go up on the block. We've got a veto winner. So, Brian, give us the update real quick.
Okay, so Amanda was America's third nominee.
Oh, no.
And Spencer won a puzzle POV.
Okay.
And we're awaiting the ceremony tomorrow.
Yes, and at this hour, it looks like the replacement nominee will be...
Will be Candace.
Candace, okay. So we got a new landscape here in nomination land. Howard, Candace, Amanda. Let's take this one by one. So, Shelley, were you surprised that America nominated Amanda, of all people?
No, not at all. I thought it would be for sure. When you watch the live feeds, you can see them turning. And you could see that the bossy, the kind of in control, kind of go after, very, you know, this is how you're going to do it, this is how you're going to do it, this is how you're going to do it. It doesn't go over well with America after a while. They like to see them play. They don't like people to be told what to do. And mm-hmm. So I saw that turning, and I think it's good for two reasons. Number one, do I think she's going to go home? No. Number two, I think it makes them squirm, and it makes her think a little bit more, like, whoa, you know, this hurts to be on the block. This is where she didn't think it was possible before, now it is. And if anyone in there had any guts and would do something, they would absolutely. When you get a big target on the block and you can take them out, you got to take them out. And Amanda and McCray needs to be the last of the Widowmakers, and somebody needs to pop that baby. And they won't. I don't think they will. I don't think they're ready to do it yet. But I wasn't surprised at all.
I feel like this is always an interesting question, but let me go into hypothetical land here. If Amanda was a man and not a woman, do you feel like that America would be nominating her as their person they would want to see on the block this week?
No, sir.
Yeah.
Well, I think it's standard. A completely double standard. Absolute, complete double standard. Absolutely. I mean, people are saying she's a bully and she's really coming on strong. We can go back every season and tell you a gentleman in every one of those seasons that were like that. But women just come across different, and people... get tired of it. And assertive women, I know I'm aggressive and competitive and assertive, and some people don't like that. They, you know, I watch it. It happened to me. They start calling her the Amanda. They'll call her a man because she acts like that. They did it to me.
Mm-hmm.
They will start to make fun of how they talk, how they walk. They did it, and I can only compare it to myself, but those things are the things in my heart of hearts that hurt. That hurts the most when you come out. Those are the things that you say, my goodness, I'm assertive, and I want to speak, and I want to win, and I want to be a leader. But women, we're still fighting for that, to be able to see, to be seen equal in that way. And I'm not a women's liber or anything else, but I also think you can do it and be classy about it.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think it helps for the other women that they're seeing her climb on top of him in the bed. It's never him on top of her. It's her mounting him.
Yeah.
It's her putting him down and her saying, do you want to go in the bathroom? It's her jumping his... And I think that that aggression, I think if she handled it in a classy way and wasn't, you know, let somebody chase her in some way, it might be different. But when you see all of that, even as a female, you start saying, my goodness, let the man wear the pants and something.
She is a woman who knows what she wants.
She does know what she wants, and she goes and gets it, with or without him. No, no pun intended. She goes and gets it every night.
Now, Brian, did I hear this correctly, that did Rachel endorse America to vote for Amanda? Did Rachel tell people on Twitter to vote for Amanda to be nominated?
I'm not aware of that, actually, so it's possible, but I didn't see that, no.
Yeah. I was just curious as to why Amanda would be the target. I mean, if would the Alyssa supporters feel like Amanda was the right choice? Can we give them credit for this?
There was a movement to get Amanda nominated on Twitter. A lot of people took offense to some things she actually said, and I mean, I think harassed her dad to the point where he dropped off Twitter. So
that was awful.
Yeah.
I mean, the parents have no reason to be attacked. Those parents go through enough anyway, because regardless, and I've said this to you before, every person on there is somebody's daughter, son, sister, or brother, and to watch them, regardless, 50% love you, 50% hate you, it's so hard on the parents, and people, you know, they start attacking the parents for what their daughter's doing, and she's a grown woman. She's making her own decisions now, and it's unfortunate, because I think her daddy and her sister, they were really trying to be very engaging with people. But when people get, she has said some questionable things, and even for a dad, there's no defense to that. I mean, my own mom and dad, when I got out, said, why in the heck did you do that? I don't understand. You know, that's not even you. Why would you do it? And, you know, parents, at some point, they're going to tell you the truth. And my mom always said, if your mama don't tell you the truth, nobody will. So it's hard for her. It's hard for them to defend her in some of the things she said. She has said some nasty things.
Even for Aaron's parents, you still subscribe to that?
I don't think Aaron's parents should be hated. I don't. I think that her parents, I don't know her mom and dad, have never spoken to them. But I certainly think that they have had, are crushed, and have had weeks of watching their daughter cause her own trouble. Don't get what I say is wrong, because she's caused her own trouble. But there are people that go to jail and do very bad things that their mom and dad still love them, and it still hurts them when their child is hurt. And that's still their baby, and it's a young girl, and a girl that has lost a job. It's not going to be real easy to go get a modeling job after this. And because models, as much as, you know, looks, things, and everything else, there are certain things that people now, you got to be kind of pretty on the inside too, and what comes out of your mouth and your thoughts. So she's going to have some rebuilding to do. I see a lot of stuff that she hired a PR agency, or her parents did. I don't know if that's true or not, but... it's hard. The social media has changed all the reality shows so much, because you have instant response to everything they do. And live feeders don't miss a thing. And I mean, even when you watch the edit tonight, it doesn't come off on the show that Amanda's telling everybody that Amanda was the biggest proponent to get Howard out, and I don't think they showed that at all. They don't reflect that she was going to everybody, Howard, Howard, it's Howard, Howard. And they didn't show that. They showed Andy, they showed Helen, but they didn't show her, and she was a huge driver of that. A huge driver of that. And then
right. When
you get, Brian will be able to see on the live feeds, when she went up on that MVP, she went to people and said, you don't take any punishment. I mean, you take all the punishments, mm-hmm. don't take prizes. I mean, she was telling them what they had to do if it was one of those veto games. And I was like looking at the thing going, STF, you, girl. I mean, just like, come on, somebody step up and get some pants.
Yeah. So at this hour, it looks like Howard is definitely going to be the one to go home on Thursday. Do either of you see any chance for Howard to be able to turn things around?
Go ahead, Shelley.
I think it will be Howard or Candace. If Candace keeps up how she's acting right now, she may get the target on her. She's pretty sore, and she's a little bit harder to control her mouth, but I think if the group that's together now, they all want Howard, because for some reason they think he's going to come out of the woodwork and start winning every competition known to man, so I'm pretty sure he'll still go.
Okay. Now, I want to bring in Brian, once again, has illustrated the alliances in the house. We have one of Brian's famous diagrams. Shelley, check this out, okay? So this is Brian's flowchart here of the alliances
awesome.
In the house. We have here in the middle the goof troop of Andy, Judd, McCray, and Amanda with knockouts, Helen and Alyssa off of that. Jesse is connected with Judd. And then an offshoot of Amanda is Aaron, and then an offshoot of Aaron is Gina Marie. And then sort of on the other side of the house, we have Candace, Howard, and Spencer. So my question was, was Candace the right person to put up on the block instead of Spencer, because she is the third person in the other isolated threesome in the house?
Yeah, I mean, it's... If they wanted to really game, they'd take him off and put McCray up with Amanda, and force try to force people to split them up. They're all talking about splitting them up, but nobody will. But yeah, for logical for where they are in the game, putting Candace up and not ruffling too many feathers is fine. Those three are in trouble that are over there.
Yeah,
and I think it's pretty easy in my opinion to tell who's going to get down to the end.
Why? Who's give us your pick? Who's getting down to the end?
I think when you get down to the last five, it's going to be Judd, Jesse, Helen, and McCray, and maybe Alyssa on that fifth, because Jesse. What, she went 6 days without going in the diary room? I don't even know. They don't even pay attention to her. She doesn't have a target on her back. Andy, he's pop up Andy, just happy go lucky Andy. Nobody's pitching at him. Judd, he doesn't have a target on him at all. McCray, once Amanda gets out of the way, I think he'll play. And he's tight with Judd. I think you'll be able to keep those together.
McCray, once Amanda gets out of the way, I think he'll play. Somebody turn that into a T-shirt.
Yeah, they'll come up with something good. Yeah, I kept making fun of somebody in one of the interviews asked Caitlin, that I guess Jeremy did a rhyme or something for Caitlin when he left the house, and somebody told Caitlin to do a rhyme and she couldn't think of one. Boy, I came up with several, but none of them can be said. But yeah, McCray is smart.
Yeah.
He understands the game. He's a very good player. I don't even think he realizes, he probably does subconsciously know that Amanda's in front of him and is blocking him, but at some point, if he wants to get to, she won't go to the end. Those two will not make it to the end together.
Yeah.
No way.
They're not going to make it to the end together, but I'll bet you anything she goes out before he does.
I agree.
Yeah.
She will go out for sure. And if they were smart, one of them needs to go before jury. And that is where there is some smartness as far as counting jury votes. If you get down to that, McCray and Amanda will vote together no matter what.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and then all the sheep that follow them, if they all go to the jury house without getting one of them out, they're going to lose votes for themselves.
All right, Brian,
I still think it's too early for that. But
give us a preview for Thursday, okay? 8 people are going to vote this week, right? So give us the votes real quick here on the board. So we know Spencer is going to vote out Amanda, right?
We would think so, right?
All right,
unless
then
he just falls in line.
I'll give you the other people, and you tell me their vote. Okay, Gina Marie.
Wow. Probably Howard, right?
Yep.
Okay. Jesse.
Howard.
Judd.
Howard.
McCray.
Howard.
Andy.
Howard.
Helen.
Howard.
Alyssa.
And she'll probably fall in line too.
Okay. Howard.
So we could end up with a unanimous vote.
Yeah, because again, Spencer won't, if he knows everybody's voting that way, he won't fall out of line.
Yeah,
and somebody should. They should get a couple people to throw a couple votes at Amanda just to stir things up.
Well, they're scared of her.
I know. And they really they should scared. Continue to. I mean, that's where, and maybe, again, it's easy to be armchair quarterback on the outside, but it would be fun to just throw a couple votes where they don't know, and Amanda's like, man, somebody wants me out, and then just watch them go poke at each other. And again, they can always blame it on Alyssa or Spencer. They can, but they could scare some people.
There's been this underground movement to get rid of Amanda by Helen for weeks now, and as soon as she ends up on the block, Helen has to run around and make sure all her votes that she's got stacked up to get rid of her are going to get rid of Howard. So she's really the one at this point pushing to save Amanda, even though she's shared so much information with people like Andy and Judd. And
today she shared
Jesse.
A pile.
Yeah, if she's not careful, if this gets lined up and before this replacement nomination happens and Amanda catches wind of some of the things Helen's been saying, because she even went around and preemptively told them that she was campaigning to get rid of Amanda. Hey, just so y'all know, I'm trying to get rid of you, Amanda. You're going to hear this from Candace. So
Helen's going to suffer the same fate I did. She's going to be figured out because she's talking too much, and people start. She's got a web of lies that she's going to have a hard time getting out of now. I mean, she's catching herself in lies now. When that starts happening, you know you're in trouble because you will be saying something and you will know at that moment that it's coming out of your mouth that I am lying and I just gave something away. I got myself in trouble even when I will never forget saying to Rachel, Jeff threw the POV. And I didn't even mean for it to come out because she knew that he threw it and Brendan was up. And I was like, yeah, Jeff threw the POV. And I was just like, oh, I didn't mean for that just to come out. And if I could have taken it back, but it was out. But you get so loose and the webs get crossed and they start, and Helen's forgotten.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So
and
it'll catch her.
The season is going to be about like 20 days longer than the regular season. So this is.
Might be 20 days too long.
Could be. All right, we've got still a bunch of stuff to get to, and I know we're starting to run a little long here. So, Brian, anything else from the live feeds you want to let us know about before we can bring in Jessica with your questions?
I got a bunch of stuff from the live feeds. Like, we hadn't talked about Howard addressing the people in the kitchen and asking them not to disrespect his religion because the rumor was going around that he was using religion to bolster his game, and that was being used as like campaigning against Howard for the votes, basically.
Was anybody actually doing that, or was that Howard is just like building this straw man of it? I hear people are talking about my religion.
Well, you know, there's a lot of people say Howard is using his religion in his game. A lot of people say, well, he prays with people of like beliefs as him. I mean, personally, I've seen him go to McCray and share Bible verses with him, and McCray has said that he doesn't believe in a Christian God or something. So McCray really was the one that has gone around saying that Howard's pushing religion. But it doesn't seem like it's like an offensive thing that Howard's doing if you're watching the feed, so.
Okay. What else is going on in the house over the weekend?
Let's see, Judd got really mad at Helen because she seemed sympathetic towards saving Howard. You see that, Shelley?
Yeah. And when he gets mad, it's hilarious because he just starts, cussing, like, all these words. Like, he had every, just words you don't usually hear him say, but it's like an over-the-top mad.
Like, right, really, and he's like, apologized.
Like forced. He has apologized.
Yeah, he had, like, a conversation with some people saying that he needs to clean up his act because he don't want to be perceived as, like, that guy.
Yeah.
Candace and Helen got an argument over...
Oh,
Candace said she didn't understand why Helen wouldn't get rid of Amanda. And that was part of, you know, what Helen's been doing is trying to whip up these votes. And Helen is still kind of throwing Amanda under the bus still. And Howard and Candace are at it again over Howard walking out while she was talking to Alyssa. And now Candace feels like she was disrespected and left all alone in the game. And a whole bunch of drama.
Howard might not have that much game, but either with the ladies or in the Big Brother house.
The end game here is a blindside. Yeah. They want to blindside Howard at this point.
Yeah. Okay. And do you think that is likely? Will they be able to convince Howard that something different is going on when everybody is such a big blabbermouth in this house?
I guess it's possible. Who was it? Judd, McCray, and Andy were talking about going separately to discuss with him so they wouldn't look connected about making him feel safe and feel like he's got the vote. So it's possible that he catches the blind side.
Okay. All right, so let's bring in Jessica to take some of your questions. I know you guys have a ton tonight. Jessica said lots of good questions. So here is Jessica, and she has all your questions. Jessica, how's it going?
It's good.
Yes. All right. So fire away, Jessica.
Okay.
Frey. And if Amanda's gone, McCray will play. All right. Here we go. This is from EC Girl 101. Why didn't anyone remind Aaron that whether or not she went with the majority of the house, she's always going to be at the bottom of the totem pole. She would be better off working with the minority. Well, that's one way to turn Aaron off. Tell her that. What do you guys make of that? Should Aaron have been reminded that she has no power no matter which side she goes on?
I would remind her. I would definitely remind her that she has no power, and I'd try to promise her some power if she came over to our side.
Mm-hmm.
She's definitely at the bottom of the totem. She's at the bottom everywhere, so somehow you got to boost her up with, I don't know, some kind of fake power to make her feel like she's going to get power by making this choice.
Yeah, we'll never be able to top your speech that you gave as Spencer earlier in this show, so we'll just move on from here. That was fantastic. This is from Justin's Great Journey. Do you think the house should have tried to get Alyssa out this week as she was unable to play in the veto and is also telling the secrets? That's a good point. Alyssa was not able to play in the veto this week. Should she have been the target this week?
I think she... I'm a little bit shocked she's not going up as a replacement. But yeah. It's that... You know, I mean, that's a great question because she does blab a lot. And she's on their team. And that's the part I don't get, is a person on your team is doing all that. But I still think they can use her. And that's why they don't want to get rid of her. They somehow think this MVP thing's going to come back and that she's an advantage. I also think in some of their minds they think she's not really there to play to win. That she's going to come out like she's thrown in, but she's not really competing for the money. So who knows? But I really don't understand. Maybe Brian gets it. I still don't understand why they're so gung-ho on getting Candace up. I mean, they can beat her easy. Very easy.
Brian, what's the deal?
I guess it's just because of all the personal stuff and the narrative, that Aaron and her don't like each other, no matter what the reason is, it's just going to cause drama. So it's always an easy out for her to convince her to put up Candace.
Yeah, personal doesn't make a bit of difference at the end of the game.
But so many people play personal.
Oh, they do. Yeah. They do. I mean, bitter jury last year.
All right. The next question, this is from Michael Norris. Would Shelley compare Jessie's game to Portia? She's doing a great job at not making herself a target, going back and forth, making both sides think they can use her. I think she can get to the end. Do you see another potential Portia in Jessie?
100%. I think that's a great analysis. Reminds me of her all the time. Yeah. Absolutely. And Jessie, from somebody from the first video that you're like, to now, you know, she's a sweet girl. She's a nice girl, but same thing, you know, not a whole, you know, she just kind of went along like Portia did. They even have some of the same sweatsuits, so I think he's made a brilliant observation.
Yeah, I didn't even think of that, but a good call, Michael Norris. That was a...
That's a great point, Michael.
Yeah, very, very good job comparing Portia and Jessie to each other. All right, well, let's get a couple more questions here as we move along. This is from Keith Ramage. Aaron is playing a good game in terms of keeping her emotions in check. Does Alyssa have a lesson to learn? Could Alyssa learn anything from Aaron at this point in time, Shelley?
Absolutely.
Whoa!
I do. I mean, you gotta call a spade a spade. And I think Alyssa's got to... You just can't be that emotional. You just got to let it go and not... You can't judge everybody. Hmm. I mean, we can be judgmental on the outside, but in there, if you're going to spend all your time being judgmental, and it'll never work. You will never work. So, yeah, you know, that's why I think Erin's going to have a shot when she gets out. She's got some good things. If she can keep it real and keep her emotions under control, we all can learn from each other. Even people with bad scars have good, you know... Good waves every now and then.
Alyssa really has no poker face whatsoever. Like in the episode, in that scene when Alyssa was cooking and then Aaron came in and she wanted to put the pizza in the oven, it was like Alyssa couldn't even look at her.
Alyssa and Rachel are a little bit alike. That reminded me so much of Rachel and Cassie in the kitchen.
Mm-hmm.
The difference is Rachel would have turned around and gone,
"Yeah,
Cassie," you know, and give that attitude. And Alyssa is just so disgusted by Aaron that it freezes her. Instead of trying to kill her with kindness. I mean, if you kill her with kindness, that who knows? She may help you get to the end. But, yeah, she needs to get over that.
Yeah, Aaron can be phony much better than Alyssa can. And I say that in a good way. That's a good thing to have in the Big Brother house.
It really is. You got to learn to turn the other cheek.
Yeah. Okay, this is from Rabin, who wants to know, Shelley, Andy is playing a very similar game to yours, playing both sides. When do you think is the best time for him to make a stand in the game and avoid a similar fate to yours? Now, interestingly, you said that you felt like Helen was the one who was playing the game similar to yours. Do you see similarities between your game and Andy's?
Well, I 100% agree that Andy and I are playing a more similar game. What I think the problem is that Andy's not... getting the web of lies. Andy's not as vocal going to people and pulling them out. Helen is, and I think I would kind of sit like socialize like Andy does. I'm not pop-up Andy, though. Man, that kid pops up everywhere. I think he's got three of them in there. But
DNA.
Yeah, no kidding. But I would agree he's doing much the same. He's playing both sides against the middle. And he's got probably two more weeks and he's got to pick a side. It just depends on who goes. But he's getting close to having to pick his ponies. And I could be completely wrong, but I think he will stick with Helen to the end.
All right, next question. This is from Philly Sports 0822. My question is Helen thinking way too much ahead because she's already planning who she wants on the jury, and is she starting to be a target for the other house guests? You talked about this a little bit earlier in the show, Shelley. Are they getting too far ahead of themselves, worrying about who's going to be on the jury?
Yes. You just got to take it a week at a time. And if they would stop thinking about the future, they would think about the awesome opportunity they have right now to take out a really strong player. Mm-hmm. But they're more worried about, you know, what friends are we going to allow into our precious jury? You know, that's really how they're thinking, is like, who is cool enough to hang with us and be there? And there's no couples there anyway, so it, you know, jury stinks. I mean, yeah. It's a nice house and it's a nice pool, but you don't get to talk to your family, you're not done, and you sit. It's not fun. You don't want to go there. You'd much rather win the money.
Yeah. Did you have fun in jury?
I was only there for 4 days. You know what? Fun is not. It's weird. You go there first. I had to go there. Jeff was there, and I was scared to death that he was going to just mortify me. And but we were fine. Actually, him and Danny would get into it more than him and I. But then Danny and I laid out at the pool. I got to know Danny really well, and that was great. But then they took us from the jury house to a hotel. So then we were in a hotel those last 4 days, and that was miserable. I'd rather have been in a place where you could swim and be outside. But we got locked in the hotel.
Oh, no.
So it was like, it's not fun, and you don't talk to your family. And at that point, all the people are looking at you like, America hates you, but they won't tell you. But I kept looking at them like, what is wrong? Because there are people like going, oh, we love you. You are the sweetest person. Don't let anything change when you get out of here. And I'm like, did something happen? And they won't tell you. Mm-hmm. And they're like, we just love you. We just, and then I get out and it's like, poof, you know, blow up. So that's hard because now you do, everyone, you, if you ask all of them, it's funny and I'll shut up, but every one of them thinks they're going to be MVP because they all think they're America's favorite because you don't really know in your own head what you're doing every day in there. And you don't realize how you offend people.
Yeah. Shelly, did it ever occur to you to hire a PR firm after you got out of the house like Aaron's parents did?
No. I have thick skin, and I also knew that, you know, the difference is my stuff was kind of over game things and things that maybe would have been immature, and not to mention that I got out one of the most popular players ever in history. I mean, Big Brother last week gave him the last 7 minutes of the show to do an interview. I mean, I can't compete with that. I will never be able to compete with that, and nobody can compete against them. They are loved. They have so many fans and people, and they're wonderful people, but if you evict them, if they ever play again, you're up a creek without a paddle. You're crazy. I mean, I'd never do it again. Lord, no. I'd put it on a platter and hand them the check.
Yeah.
I learned my lesson.
Just let me go to the end with you. Let me play. I'm playing for second place.
Play for third.
Play for third, yeah.
I'll take nothing, but just let me come in. But that's difficult, and I think that's why it's also – that's why the other house guests coming out think it's so fair with Alyssa, because she has a fan base. And in some cases, when you have America votes, you know, I don't think it's a big surprise at the end of the day who's going to probably get America's favorite.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And it doesn't give anybody else a chance because we didn't have those pool of people.
Yeah.
Not that I would have ever been America's favorite, but hey, I'd have loved to see, you know.
You're our favorite.
Yeah. You guys are my favorite. And you know what? You got to have thick skin. You get out of it. When I went back and watched it, if I could tell those girls all one thing right now, I would tell them to quit smoking outside. They look like fools.
Yeah.
It looks so bad, and I didn't even realize how bad it looked till I watched it, and I was mortified, but I would tell them all. Just when Helen did last night, I was like, what are you doing? Don't do that, you know? The house does stuff to you.
Stressful. It's like jail. All right, so let's take two more questions. This is from Mr. Wanton 16 wants to know, do Judd and McRae have to depend on each other to reach the end game because they're playing somewhat similar games? I don't think necessarily. I mean, what do you guys think?
No, I don't think they have to depend on anybody. Quite frankly, I think Judd could probably play with any couple of people down to the end. I think Judd has the table set for him the best. Just the way that he is, he can mold to whatever anybody wants him to be, because he's J-U-double-D.
Yeah, Party Darty.
Party Darty.
Yeah. Brian, I know you're a big Judd fan. Do you think he needs to work with McRae to get to the end?
Yeah, he has been working with McRae a lot, obviously. I agree with Shelly. He could go pretty much anywhere, but he's not going to come under attack like McRae is, because they're going to go after Amanda, and McRae's game's going to have to change. Judd can kind of sell in a way.
Mm-hmm. Judd's going to be there at the end, without a doubt. He's a great guy.
One last question here with Shelly. This is from T Dark Horse 4. Is anybody ever going to figure out that guys like McRae need to go early? I'm a huge McRae fan, but nobody realizes how dangerous he is. Now, every season we see people come into the Big Brother house. It's like, oh, this guy's a competition threat. We got to get rid of this guy. And I don't know. Is it chicken or the egg? Do these guys never win the game because they always get targeted early? Or what's the opposite of that? They get targeted early because they never win the game? Which is it?
I think I forget his name, Mr. Wonton?
Yes, Mr. Wonton.
Mr. Wonton, yeah. It's an awesome observation. And it seems like more and more each season that goes by, the most interesting people that you want to see win the game go out.
Mm-hmm.
And the ones that are, you know, that are fun to watch and that they do create the drama. And McRae, he's smart and they don't see it. And the thing is he's quiet and he has somebody to hide behind. And when you have somebody to hide behind, to win the game, you always have to have a target that's bigger than you. And you've got to be able to kind of play that smooth role. And he's got his wontons, he's got his girlfriend, he's got his bubble baths, and he's sailing right now. And he's going to float her boat till he floats her right out. And then, Wonton, you might be right, because I think he will win. He will come down to the end. I really think Judd's going to win it. I really, really do. Because I think he has the ability to win when he needs to, but I think McRae mentally and in endurance challenges towards the end will do very well if they don't get him out.
I think McRae's going to have two lives in this game. I think he's going to have the live with Amanda in the house, and then I think once Amanda goes out, probably like first or second on the jury, then I think he's going to have a second life in this game by himself, and I think he's going to do very well in that second life.
Yep. Zucker face and post.
Yeah.
There you
no
go.
More kissy kissy. He can start kissing butt instead of kissing up her.
Yeah. I mean, in some ways, like, if he could just sort of, I mean, and we even had this with Brendan and Rachel on your season, where after Brendan got out of the house, you know, Rachel had had more game than when Brendan was there. She was able to focus more. So
absolutely.
Yeah, as long as McRae doesn't get into, like, hey, now you guys voted out Amanda, and now you all have to pay. I'm going to make your life hell because I want to be with Amanda. As long as he doesn't go there and he's like, okay, look, I got to play the cards I'm dealt now, I think he could have a very good second life in this game.
I hope he comes out, you know, she goes out and he puts on a Braveheart ponytail and like Brendan in that rope gang that one season, and he paints mud all over himself. He's like, I got it for you, man. I'm coming. You know, he paints that American flag back on his face, and that'd be hilarious. But no, and I don't think he's going to be the kind of guy that's so girl crazy. You know, she'll want him to be, tell me you love me, tell me you miss me, tell me. Mm-hmm. He's not going to be that way. Guys, most normal ones aren't that way. No.
Just remember, guys, nobody gets in between me and my Manda. Yeah.
There you go.
Now that will be repeated many times out there. That's gonna get a lot of airtime, Rob.
Yeah. All right. Let's go out on that. All right, Shelley Moore. Thank you so much. This was fantastic. Such great insight. Such a fun guest. You know the game so well. So it's truly a pleasure to talk to you, Shelley.
Well, I thank you guys, Brian. Awesome to see you. Thanks, everybody.
Great to see y'all.
Yes,
I appreciate you.
Yeah, great job again this week. Fantastic chart, Brian. If you want to hear more from Brian Lynch, you can check him out at LynchMGM. And if you want to follow Shelly on Twitter, it's at ShellyMooreBB13. Is that right?
That's right.
There you
Come
go.
Come see us in the BB Strategy Room on the live feeds. Come see us sometime, Brian.
I will.
All right, man. They'll come and welcome you with pleasure.
Yeah, and thank you.
I'm ShellyMooreBB13 in there too, Brian, so...
Look
for me. All right, baby. Thanks, y'all. So nice to see you.
Yeah, all right. Take care, everybody. The Whodunit podcast, look for that on Tuesday morning. And if you are not subscribed to our YouTube channel and you'd like to be, go to robhaswebsite.com/YouTube. We'll be back with more podcasts. Right now, I don't have anything scheduled other than Whodunit before Thursday night with Ian Terry. But if anything comes up, follow me on Twitter. I'll let you know what's going on. I'm at Rob Cesternino. Have a great week, everybody. And we'll talk to you again soon. Take care, everybody. Bye. Coming to you live from my apartment, it's Rob Has a Podcast. And now here's the guy who only wishes that Clowny could be the one that was unforgettable. Rob Cesternino, hello everybody, and welcome back to our special live edition of our Big Brother podcast here. And we are live after the Sunday night edition of Big Brother 15. And we have a tremendously special guest with us here today. We spoke to her last season, and it was so much fun, and she's good enough to come back and join us this summer to talk about Big Brother 15. Here she is from Big Brother 13. It's Shelley Moore.
Hey, how are y'all?
Yes, and we wanted more Shelley, and here she is.
I got the name for it, right?
Yes, perfect. And Shelley, I know how badly you would have liked to have discussed Aaron being evicted this week, but unfortunately we're going to talk about Aaron being the head of household.
I know. Big Brother karma, it always happens that way.
Yes, that's how it always happens. And then and this is how this always happens. We have our live feed expert here with us on the line, Mr. Brian Lynch. Brian, how are you doing?
I'm doing well. It's good to see both of y'all.
Yes, good.
To see you.
Yeah, and Brian, did you get a haircut?
Yeah, I got a haircut about a week ago.
Wow, looking sharp, looking very sharp tonight, Brian. All right.
Thank you very much.
So we are here live on Robin's website and on our YouTube channel. We hit a big milestone this week on the YouTube channel. We passed 7,000 subscribers on our YouTube channel. So thanks to all of you guys who are watching the show and subscribing on our YouTube. If you want to get in on this, you can go to robhasawebsite.com/YouTube and go there and subscribe anytime. And just one other note before we jump into this, our Whodunit podcast, if you're waiting for that tonight, that's going to be delayed by one day. So I will have that up for you on Tuesday morning rather than Monday morning. I'm actually going to go, Shelley, get this. The Big Brother Canada people are in town this week, and I'm going to be going to a Big Brother reunion, I guess.
Good.
Yes.
That's great.
I will be visiting with some Big Brother people and hopefully trying to find some more guests for Rob as a podcast.
They'll be knocking down your door.
No.
You're going to get a whole bunch of new subscribers tonight. I have to do this, but on the live feeds, and Brian, you probably know this, but I hang out in the BB Strategic Talk Room. It's the best room on the live chats. We talk probably every night, every day, and just a great group of people. It's fun to get in there and really talk to the real fans, and they were all going to come listen to you tonight. So shout out to the BB Strategic Talk Room. They're just fantastic.
Yeah, so that's
Ian comes there, and a bunch of people come there all the time. It makes it a lot of fun. Those are the real fans.
Yeah, so that's on the live feeds. There's a special Strategic Talk chat room, and you go there and interact with the fans. That's great, Shelley.
Yeah, no, they're a lot of fun. It makes it fun to see how they see the game.
Yeah. All right, well, and I'm sure that they are thrilled when you come in and hang out, just like we're thrilled to have you here.
Oh, thank you.
Yes. All right, well, Shelley, let's get into this. And I know we've been emailing for a couple of weeks now about this, and you've been saying from the get-go you do not like the Aaron. Now she is the new woman in charge of the Big Brother house, or at least is just a figurehead of the woman in charge of the Big Brother house.
Yeah, but let's talk
about Aaron in sort of the broad strokes. Have you ever seen anything like this before in your Big Brother watching history of Aaron?
No, Aaron kind of falls into a category all by herself. You know, it's interesting to watch her because the more I watch her, the more I realize that she's probably just very young, inexperienced, hasn't learned a whole lot of things that you think a child, a girl, a woman at that age would know. And I think a lot of it boils down to the fact that she has spent a lot of time in her life worrying about from this part out instead of what falls in here.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that some of the things she says come out now as very rude and aggressive and not very nice. And I think what she said is deplorable. It's kind of taught me a lot of things because I thought we were way past that.
Mm-hmm.
So when it started happening, I was shocked. But it's hilarious to watch her over the last couple of days because she's cleaning the kitchen. She's picking up towels. You know, you just wonder if anybody, little bird from the outside, has said, you better clean up your act. Because,
yeah.
You know, she's just, it's like this 180-degree turn. You know, she says she's going to muzzle herself, then she doesn't muzzle herself. Of all the people, I never thought she would keep her deal in nominations tonight. I certainly didn't think, really, I would have kept Caitlin thinking that she was more malleable, more pliable. You could probably keep her and get her to go with you easier. Aaron was a little more stubborn, and she's actually letting Helen and Amanda run her HOH, which, you know, blows my mind, but... you know, the real payday comes after you get out of the Big Brother house. I can speak from experience. And hopefully she has 2 ears and 1 mouth and listens and reads and learns and comes out of it a better person. I don't want the girl to be hated or threatened or her life ruined. She's so young, but she's got a lot to learn, and I hope she learns it. She's going to learn some of it the hard way. But if they don't get her out before jury, we're never going to see any of the Julie questions, which will be the highest rated show ever.
Yeah, it would be good. So a bunch of interesting stuff that you said there. One thing about Aaron's youth. Now, do you feel like it's an advantage to go into the Big Brother house and like to not be basically the oldest people they put in the Big Brother house are like people like in their 30s. But is that a big advantage going in the Big Brother house to have like all this life experience of somebody who's not being, who's not 22 years old? Do you feel like that's does that help you in the game?
I think it cuts both ways. For Erin, she's going to get out and people are going to say she's young and hasn't made those mistakes yet to learn. When you go in, you're older, be it an Amanda, a Helen, myself, and you hide a dog or do stupid things, people say you're a mom. You should know better. You're 40.
Mm-hmm.
So that can cut both ways. I mean, I think a lot of the things that went on so far this season are things that are kind of taught at home or learned. I think in a way they think they're trying to be funny. And everybody has a different sense of humor. On Big Brother, you can offend people by just trying to be funny, and you can offend people by truly being offensive. It all matters what the audience is. You know, it's a game, so people say, hey, you know, they're just trying to fit in. They're trying to do the things they do. But the bottom line is there are some things in life that are just better left unsaid, or at least not said in the forum that they're saying, because they're just flat wrong. So as a mom going in there, I got crucified, rightly so, for some of the immature things I did because I was 40.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Amanda's a little bit older, and she's doing some things in there that I don't think somebody her age should be doing either. So, you know, it is great entertainment. I got to give her that. But sometimes you wonder if they sit there and think after all the seasons that they've seen. I don't think a lot of these kids have seen very much Big Brother.
Yeah.
I think they've seen a season or two and don't. When they don't understand that there's flashback and there's feeds and the people that are the fans of the show will screenshot and go back and watch everything, I don't think they all completely know what they get into. But you definitely expect more out of an adult. Erin's going to come out with that advantage that she's younger and people give her a chance that she has all those years to yet fix it and learn. You know, if I went in and did things like that, which I don't even think that's a part of me, but I also didn't think I'd hide somebody's dog. So in the house, things different do happen.
Yeah.
And it's just really, a lot of people have said coming out that the pressure in there is very different, and you do get frustrated and you act a totally different way. And I think when Erin comes out and she actually physically has to look at what she did, she's going to feel horrible. And I hope that she just does the right things going about it. She's got to own it. And she's got to truly make a change. And I hope that she handles it, not necessarily publicly, but privately, goes back to the people that she hurt. Because what I noticed is I don't think Helen still realizes that she has said anything about her. So Helen is like feeding Erin, we're going to protect you, we're going to protect you. I don't think even that Helen realizes the full scope of it at this point.
Yeah, I doubt she realizes the full scope. I remember that at least at one conversation where Howard was sort of telling her about some of the things that she had been saying. So I think she knows some of it, and kudos to Helen for being able to keep her eye on the prize and not get caught up in it. But I think you're right that for whoever is advising Erin when she gets out of the house, she needs to own, you know, the things that she said and say, oh, you know, people, what I said wasn't even that bad. How can people say that?
And that will be the wrong way to go about it.
Go.
I mean, very much. I mean, even Caitlin, watching her, she's trying to put it all on Erin.
Mm-hmm.
And you see her saying, well, gosh, I got a scapegoat over here. I can dump it on her. And I'm even seeing over the past couple days that she's trying to own up a little bit. So either you mean it that you apologize or you don't. If you don't mean it, don't say it. Just go on with your life and be who you're going to be. And people will choose to like you for that or not like you for that. But and then you get away from that whole issue and say, it's not a personal game. You can't play the game as personal. And if the game had been personal, all the times they've tried to get Aaron out, be it by America or by their own doing, it's not happening. So you might as well see what she can do. And who knows? I mean, I just pray that that woman does not make it to the end, because could you imagine trying to turn a check over to that girl at the end?
Yeah.
Oh, Lord. Could that would just be awful for everybody involved. So hopefully somebody gets their stuff together and road test before they came in there, because they rate off the charts. There's a whole bunch of showmancing going on. They're young and in love. What can you say? I always think there's going to be a little Wiz Khalifa playing in the background, huh?
Yeah. How funny was Amanda with Clowney in the diary room tonight?
That was really good. It was really cute. I thought that was funny. She's great for that entertainment. She really is. She's good at it. It's second nature to her. She's very entertaining in the diary room.
Yeah, she's fantastic.
I enjoy that. I think it's neat.
Yeah. And also in the hall, we had the old hide-and-go-seek on the HOH. That's always a crowd-pleaser.
That was good. I thought that, when I saw that, I was like, oh, my gosh, where are they? You know, people aren't, and I didn't realize that they had hidden. But that was great. Yeah, that was fun, and it makes it fun. And
did you guys do that in your season? I feel like, did you guys do it to Rachel?
We did a pillow. We all hid with pillows when she came out and launched the pillows at her. So, yeah, that was nice, and that was fun. And that clown being in there again was that thing is – that'll go down in infamy. That and the bear shirt, I think, that'll be talked about forever.
Yeah. So in the midst of all of the fun and games in Aaron's HOH room, Aaron catches herself because she said axed instead of asked. And she blames that on Candace. She says, oh, my God, I'm hanging out with you too much. I just said axe.
Where if you do that you just keep going. I mean, I don't even know. And she kept going back to it and saying it again.
Yeah.
And when the lights are on you, it's going to shine brighter. Nobody's going to miss any of that now. So the light, it just gets brighter and brighter and brighter. And the guilty sign gets bigger and bigger and bigger. And that... as soon as I heard that, I was like, oh, my gosh, that'll be the thing. I mean, that was just – she blamed it on her. I mean, she should have just said she misspoke. I mean, that's just young.
Yeah.
Just doesn't get it.
She's just like, oh, my God, I said axed, and I get that from you because you say that all the time.
And then Howard's face is just like, you know. I'm sure that they will – he talks. I laugh when he does talk because he's very good at calming her down, Candace.
Yeah.
But I when I try to follow him talking, I don't follow what he is doing. He talks in circles. He's such a sweet man and a kind man and just takes such good care of himself and everything. I can't follow what he's doing at all.
Yeah. So then after we had the HOH room, we had an extended McCray and Amanda in the bath. Shelly, I know you can't get enough of them on the live feeds. Did you need to see McCray and Amanda in the bath tonight?
No, I really don't. I really don't. I'm like, but I can tell you, I'm sure all the people that love their little showmance and they're making McBabies and McGrandas and all that, that's all great. I think it's totally different for a mom. Because I think for her mom going, oh, my gosh, her mom's got to be mortified, her father. You know, I worry about them because half the people probably think it's great and half don't. So in my head, I'm like, oh, Lord, what are you doing? You know, it was kind of cute at the end when he, I don't know, made some bubbles in the tub.
I didn't know it was a jacuzzi in the HOH.
Yeah, no kidding. You know, it was cute how they did it, but... sometimes when she talks to him, it creeps me out because I feel like it's a mother, like she mothers him, like talking to her son, like, oh, and she's always like grooming him in that, what I always call it the fortune teller room. But whenever they're in there, she's always like fixing his hair, asking him if he's going to change his shirt. And sometimes I'm like, you act like you're his mom.
Yeah.
You know, no man wants a nag, period. I don't care anyway. The one quality I think no man wants is a naggy woman to tell him what to do.
I don't think McCray's complaining too much, Shelly.
I think he's a very happy man. I really do. I mean, and honestly, I think it's for real. I think they really do like each other a lot.
Yeah.
So, and if he doesn't, that's awful for her, but he has put a huge target in front of him.
Yeah.
And she is doing the heavy lifting. And she is taking the heat, and you know, America was really pro-Amanda. Now, you know, it's funny. I saw something on one of the websites. I thought it was brilliant, but they always say, you know, Amanda's stock is falling, sell, 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 or Judd's stock is falling, sell, 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 because people get so high on somebody, and then you see them do something, and they go the other way.
Mm-hmm.
And you can turn on a house guest this fast. I mean, people will love you one minute, the next minute, if you do something to one of that, you're awful, and it can go sadly the other way
very
quickly.
Yes, yes, you seem like you know about that show.
I know so much about it, so... it's fun because it's a lot more fun watching it on this side of the TV than the other side of the TV.
Yeah. So, and I forgot to mention at the top of the show, this is live and interactive, and we are going to be taking your questions about Big Brother and about everything going on in the house, and your questions for Shelley in a little bit. So if you want to get your questions in, Jessica Frey is behind the scenes. She's in the chat room. She is watching on the YouTube video. If you post your questions on the YouTube video itself, we can take them and put them on the screen, or if you use the hashtag RHAP over on Twitter. And so we're just going to keep going along here, and then later on we'll get into the live feeds and everything that happened after the nominations with Brian. So a lot still coming up here on this show. So Spencer and Howard both went about making their pitches to Aaron in different ways. So Spencer took the direct approach, and he went to go talk to Aaron. And what did you think about Spencer's pitch to try to save himself from going up on the block?
He was direct, but none of them turn over their directness to say, okay, this is why I want to stay, and here's what we can do. All he said is, hey, I think you can get more numbers if you go like this.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you got to put it out in front of her. I mean, you got to understand that she, in her mind, has these people that have saved her and are going to keep her in the house. So if you don't give her a very good pitch on why she should come over to you and not put, but especially when she's got all this backup, you know, she's got 14 people in her spine saying, you can do it. They're holding her up. So you've got to try to turn it the other way. So I think his pitches are always such a soft sell, and he's kind of just like this, that it just doesn't come across as good or genuine or even worth it. He just doesn't strike me as a player. And what's interesting is when he first, off of his video, when I first watched him, I thought his personality would really shine, that he would be somebody that, you know, had some game. And I just, he doesn't seem to have game at all. And, you know, he seems to work Jesse, and you feel like he would go through her and try. She's very malleable. You could mold her wherever you want her to go and keep Judd close. But I don't think either one of their pitches were very good, and I think that's why they're both up there. And you've got to somehow figure out how to get a group and get that group to go together. But when you have a bunch of sheep, you know, they're going to all follow their little shepherd, and they know who that is right now. Nobody will go over here and ring a bell and say, hey, come over here. Yeah. I got better food, or I got a better opportunity. They just won't do it because they're all playing for safety right now.
So, Shelley, how do you walk that fine line between, let's say you're Spencer and you're worried about going up on the block, like, how do you go up there and talk to the HOH and say, here's what I wanted, like, here's my plan, here's what I think we should do, and here's whom I think we should target, and not have the HOH turn around and go tell that person that you said that I want to go target you?
Yeah, that's the hard part, and I think you have to handle that from both sides. I think you can go to Aaron and say, hey, listen, this is what we're doing. You've got to think about the fact that if you continue to have... Alyssa's been the widowmaker. She has broken up all the couples, okay? She's broken up all the pairs. Now, you have to go in there with this pitch and say, listen, everybody's playing on their own now except for two people. They're playing together. And if we don't find a way to at least break them up, listen, I know you're close with both of them and you'll still have one, but now you've gained me in this posse of people. But you've got to think past it a little bit. You've got to think about how we go forward. You break them up, and now you gain this other six people. But you have to understand, Aaron, and you got to tell her, Aaron, they have all said, you can believe them or not, but they're going to dump you the first second they can get to dump you. Amanda and McCray will never turn on each other. Aaron and Andy and Helen are not going to turn on each other. Alyssa will follow Helen. And you have to show her that Gina's not going to help you. She's alone out here. So why don't we pull our posse together and go over here and make it happen? And I think you have to approach it from both sides. And I think in some ways you've got to find somebody on the other side to go with you. That if you make a threat to her to say, if you go talk and you know who she's talking to, if you go and on the backside get them to fall in with you that to say, you know, I'm going to go tell Shelly that you said that, or I'm going to go tell whoever that you said that, that threat works a little bit better. At this point, with how scared they are about a coup d'etat, I would fake that I had it if I was that desperate as them. I would say, listen, I have a power, and if you don't talk about it, I get to share it with one other person, but you've got to keep your mouth shut. If you talk, you're out. And I promise you, you're out. And what? I would, as much as they're all talking about it and stressed about it, I would do it. If I knew my butt was on the block like it was, I mean, that's where things like pulling rings out of your pocket, and you just got to figure any way possible, but they have to understand what makes her tick. I mean, if you tell her, I will get you a bottle of hair dye, she might look at it. You know, if I get you new extensions, I mean, you got to find what...
But, you know, who knows? I mean, maybe he thought that that was actually a good idea, but it obviously wasn't. If he wanted to do something, maybe going, getting her to go to Alyssa or to Amanda to get into Aaron's ear instead of just going straight to Aaron, I thought might work better.
Yeah, Brian, that's a great point. Really is.
Yeah. So do you think that Howard has played a good game to this point? I mean, he is. It seems to be that he's really got the Amanda McCray group coming after him pretty hard at this point. Do you like Howard's game so far?
Not really. I like Howard. I think he's a neat guy. But he's letting everybody walk on him. He doesn't... His talking and his engage... I don't... He's got like a super Spider-Man type mentality. Like he can be back and wear his clothes and his cape and everything, and at some point he's going to all of a sudden... Everyone thinks he's going to bust open his shirt and he's going to be a comp beast. I mean... I don't think he's throwing competitions, number one. I don't think he's very good at competitions. I think he has tried to play this game at the beginning that he was very under the radar and very much a come-to-me game. If they want to talk to me, they'll come to me. It doesn't. You've got to endear yourself to people to be able to get in a group, and I just don't think he's doing that. I think he separates himself from the group quite a bit. Watch him. He never eats with anybody else. He always goes and sits at the table alone to eat. In the beginning, obviously, for his own choice, he was going and praying and doing, and that's fine. I think, as with anything in the house, if you come in real big, anything, religion, and people start telling you to swear on your Bible, it never works well. They think you're shady because you're going to lie in the house. Mm-hmm. So, and then when people force you to do that, it just gets out of control too quick. So I don't think he knew how he was going to play, and then I think when he got in there, the game got a little bit over his head. I think he is a very kind guy. Sometimes kind. Kind only seems to work for the Jeffs and Jordans of the world. Sometimes kind doesn't work for other people. And you really do have to be a very special person to get through this game, being kind and being liked through the whole thing. It's hard, and he's a beast. I don't even know if there was an endurance competition because he's so big, like a Jesse or those guys. I don't think he could stay on very long anyway because he's so muscular. So, and obviously in the water challenge, he hated that challenge. He didn't like that one. And the one he threw with Aaron dumping the stuff on her face, I thought he won that. He won the hearts of all of us in that one. I got to tell you, he won in my book on that one.
Yeah,
I thought it was hilarious.
All right, well, we've got so much to get to from the live feeds over the weekend. So for you non-spoiler people, hey, this is the point you're going to want to check out and then come back and listen to the rest of this if you're interested on Wednesday after the episode. And now I will now open up the floor to discuss everything that has happened since since the nominations. It's spoiler time.
Oh.
All right. We're free to discuss everything now at this point.
I brought the chicken fried rice up too early.
No, that's fine. That's fine.
I'm sorry.
Fine. Brian, at this hour, we have America's has nominated somebody to go up on the block. We've got a veto winner. So, Brian, give us the update real quick.
Okay, so Amanda was America's third nominee.
Oh, no.
And Spencer won a puzzle POV.
Okay.
And we're awaiting the ceremony tomorrow.
Yes, and at this hour, it looks like the replacement nominee will be...
Will be Candace.
Candace, okay. So we got a new landscape here in nomination land. Howard, Candace, Amanda. Let's take this one by one. So, Shelley, were you surprised that America nominated Amanda, of all people?
No, not at all. I thought it would be for sure. When you watch the live feeds, you can see them turning. And you could see that the bossy, the kind of in control, kind of go after, very, you know, this is how you're going to do it, this is how you're going to do it, this is how you're going to do it. It doesn't go over well with America after a while. They like to see them play. They don't like people to be told what to do. And So I saw that turning, and I think it's good for two reasons. Number one, do I think she's going to go home? No. Number two, I think it makes them squirm, and it makes her think a little bit more, like, whoa, you know, this hurts to be on the block. This is where she didn't think it was possible before, now it is. And if anyone in there had any guts and would do something, they would absolutely. When you get a big target on the block and you can take them out, you got to take them out. And Amanda and McCray needs to be the last of the Widowmakers, and somebody needs to pop that baby. And they won't. I don't think they will. I don't think they're ready to do it yet. But I wasn't surprised at all.
I feel like this is always an interesting question, but let me go into hypothetical land here. If Amanda was a man and not a woman, do you feel like that America would be nominating her as their person they would want to see on the block this week?
No, sir.
Yeah.
Well, I think it's standard. A completely double standard. Absolute complete double standard. Absolutely. I mean, people are saying she's a bully and she's really coming on strong. We can go back every season and tell you a gentleman in every one of those seasons that were like that. But women just come across different, and people get tired of it. And assertive women, I know I'm aggressive and competitive and assertive, and some people don't like that. They, you know, I watch it. It happened to me. They start calling her the Manda. They'll call her a man because she acts like that. They did it to me.
Mm-hmm.
They will start to make fun of how they talk, how they walk. They did it. And I can only compare it to myself, but those things are the things in my heart of hearts that hurt. That hurts the most when you come out. Those are the things that you say, my goodness, I'm assertive and I want to speak and I want to win and I want to be a leader. But women, we're still fighting for that, to be able to see, to be seen equal in that way. And I'm not a women's liber or anything else, but I also think you can do it and be classy about it. And I don't think it helps for the other women that they're seeing her climb on top of him in the bed. It's never him on top of her. It's her mounting him.
Yeah.
It's her putting him down and her saying, do you want to go in the bathroom? It's her jumping his mom. And I think that aggression, I think if she handled it in a classy way and wasn't, you know, let somebody chase her in some way, it might be different. But when you see all of that, even as a female, you start saying, my goodness, let the man wear the pants and something.
She's a woman who knows what she wants.
She does know what she wants, and she goes and gets it, with or without him. No, no pun intended. She goes and gets it every night.
Now, Brian, did I hear this correctly, that did Rachel endorse America to vote for Amanda? Did Rachel tell people on Twitter to vote for Amanda to be nominated?
I'm not aware of that, actually, so it's possible, but I didn't see that, no.
Yeah. I was just curious as to why Amanda would be the target. I mean, would the Alyssa supporters feel like Amanda was the right choice? Can we give them credit for this?
There was a movement to get Amanda nominated on Twitter. A lot of people took offense to some things she actually said, and I mean, I think harassed her dad to the point where he dropped off Twitter, so...
That was awful. Yeah. I mean, the parents have no reason to be attacked. Those parents go through enough anyway, because regardless, and I've said this to you before, every person on there is somebody's daughter, son, sister, or brother, and to watch them, regardless, 50% love you, 50% hate you, it's so hard on the parents, and people... You know, they start attacking the parents for what their daughter's doing, and she's a grown woman. She's making her own decisions now, and it's unfortunate because I think her daddy and her sister, they were really trying to be very engaging with people. But when people get, she has said some questionable things, and even for a dad, there's no defense to that. I mean, my own mom and dad, when I got out, said, "Why in the heck did you do that? I don't understand. You know, that's not even you. Why would you do it?" And you know, parents, at some point, they're going to tell you the truth. And my mom always said, if your mama don't tell you the truth, nobody will. So it's hard for her. It's hard for them to defend her in some of the things she said. She has said some nasty things.
Even for Aaron's parents, you still subscribe to that?
I don't think Aaron's parents should be hated. I don't. I think that her parents, I don't know her mom and dad, have never spoken to them. But I certainly think that they have are crushed and have had weeks of watching their daughter cause her own trouble. Don't get what I say is wrong, because she's caused her own trouble. But there are people that go to jail and do very bad things that their mom and dad still love them. And it still hurts them when their child is hurt. And that's still their baby. And it's a young girl, and a girl that has lost a job. It's not going to be real easy to go get a modeling job after this. And because models, as much as, you know, looks, things, and everything else, there are certain things that people now, you got to be kind of pretty on the inside too, and what comes out of your mouth and your thoughts. So she's going to have some rebuilding to do. I see a lot of stuff that she hired a PR agency, or her parents did. I don't know if that's true or not, but it's hard. She realizes she needs to hit the road soon.
All right, well, a couple more just big picture things before we get into tonight's episode. You played in your season with returning players come back. You had newbies, and then you had returning players coming back in pairs. This season we have all new players with the exception, all new players, but we have one person who's not like everybody else in Rachel's sister. Now, you've famously played with Brendan and Rachel. Did you ever meet Rachel's sister before this season?
I did. I met her at their wedding.
Ooh.
And my husband got to spend a lot of time with her in the green room when I was voting for her to win. So he was not a bit surprised when she was cast. That was hilarious. And his first thing was, "Oh my gosh, what are they doing?" You know. But she is a very sweet girl. The times I've met her, she's very sweet. And she's losing it, I think, on the show a little bit. I'm not sure what's going on there. I mean, anybody that looks at her, I'll tell you what, I'd kill for her body. She's a gorgeous, I mean, I'm signing up for yoga if it does that to you. I mean, sign me up. I'll take hoagie yatties, lagalotties. I don't even know half the things, but if I can do a couple of those poses, I'm going to have one happy hubby at home.
Yeah.
But she's I can't follow, she just is not the same player as Rachel. I mean, the strategy, I don't know what it is. And for her, I can honestly say I appreciate that she wants to be this good and loving and very kind person, and that's fantastic, but that is not going to work in that house.
Mm-hmm.
You cannot go and judge and judge and judge. It just doesn't work. You either have to get over the personal vendetta and move on, or it'll be your downfall. So, and she does talk. I mean, I'm shocked when people go and tell her things now, because really they all go blab. I don't know anybody that keeps their mouth shut. Every time you say something, Helen is like, "Okay, now don't tell. Don't tell. Don't tell. Okay, don't tell. I won't. I won't. I promise. It's just between you and me. It's just between you and me." The second they walk away from each other, it's like, and they are off to the races. And the story becomes bigger and better each time you tell people, and it gets a little more added to it each time. But, I mean, sometimes I think Alyssa's really smart about what she's saying, like when she went out to Caitlin. you know, to try to say, hey, so-and-so's, you know, and then Aaron's like, well, you know, you're talking my name and you're talking about me. And, you know, she wasn't necessarily talking about her, but she was talking around her to get her fire lit a little bit. So in some of those things, I think it's pretty smart, but I can't, the strategy is really hard to follow in there.
Mm-hmm.
It's really hard. It's just everybody talks all the time. And I was a talker. I mean, I got information from both sides, but I kept going back to the same people. These guys tell anybody that they think. I mean, I think if somebody comes to Helen and says, Andy wants you out, she would have him up on the block as fast as she can against everybody else, because anytime they say her name, she wants him up. Yeah, and well, none of them realize that Amanda and McCray sitting behind Amanda are running the entire house, and Helen's the mouthpiece of them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It blows my mind.
All right, well, let's get into some of this strategy going on in the house. And we had a lot of the episode focused on Aaron's HOH and this deal that she made with Helen. Yeah. And Shelley, call me crazy. I think Aaron is playing particularly well right now.
So do I. It makes me awful. You have to give her a little bit of props. You really do. If you're looking solely at game, she's figured out how to be nice, play nice, and get back in people's good graces to get into the number side. And if she had gone up and blown up, I wish she would have blown up nominations and done something totally different. It would have given us more to talk about, because this is very much what is expected. But yeah, she has. You got to give her credit. If she wants to stay in the game, she's playing that part much better right now.
Because this deal she made with Helen is like the best thing she could have ever done. She gets yep. the HOH, she gets the safety, and basically she's sort of like going around like, oh, my hands are tied. I gave away my nominations. I want to help you, Howard. I want to help you, Spencer, but I just exactly. have to do what Helen wants, and she's, you know, she holds my life in her hands, and I have to do what she wants. And Helen, I'm doing exactly what you want, see? And so she's really in, like, this wonderful position where she's able to completely, like, where it looked like you would have bet anything she was out of the game on Thursday. She's able to sort of nosedive, and she's back in a pretty good spot.
I mean, she ought to bet on 36 with a heavy ball every day of the week, because that little drop ball, I mean, that's one of those luck challenges that anybody could have got. And she's gone in and put the target bigger on Helen now, mm-hmm. bigger on everybody else, and her hands are just like this. And she is just scot-free, and they will probably carry her a couple more weeks because she's playing nice. I mean, she's cleaning the kitchen and making fried rice in the house now.
Whoa.
It blows you away what she's doing now. It's totally the opposite of everything else she was doing. Brian, if you've been watching, you're probably saying the same thing, like, oh my gosh, what is going on?
Brian, you know, are you amazed by Alyssa, Aaron's transformation?
Yeah, Aaron's definitely turned a new leaf since Caitlin's eviction.
Okay.
Yeah, we'll just see what happens. Yeah, we'll see what happens with that leaf as the week goes, you know?
Yeah. And how's
is it a poisonous leaf? Is it an apple under that leaf? I think it's beyond her to keep it all under control very much longer. Because it's easy to be in control when you're in power. I mean, that's the one thing in the house. If you can get power, which I could never get power, so I could never make a decision or keep the control on my... She has control, so everybody sucks up. And this is a really sucky, uppy bunch of people when you're in HOH. My heavens. I mean, they really do. They're up there. I mean, it's even funny. Spencer's not even in the in crowd, and he sits up there, and it's just kind of like, wow. You know, they all suck up really well.
Yeah. How's about this for the icing on the cake for Aaron? So then I guess Aaron tells Jesse about the deal that she had, and I guess Jesse told Candace about the deal. And so Candace confronts Helen, and Helen assumes that Alyssa is the one who blabbed about the deal. And Helen is saying, okay, next, we got to get Alyssa out of the game.
Yeah, man, so, she turned on her quick, didn't she?
Yeah.
Turned on her. That big old bus was coming down the road, and she just chucked her out in the middle of the road. But their game of telephone is so flawed that they have the thing for the Helens and the Andes and those people is they have scapegoats. They can always throw it on Alyssa. They can always throw it on Aaron. They always have somebody right now in front of them to throw it on. And they that's how they're going to play, is they're going to figure out who they can throw under the bus, who they can blame. They have been trying to figure out who to blame since the first vote they ever took. The moving company tried to put votes out there and said, okay, we'll get Candace to take the blame for that. For some reason this year, everybody's trying to figure out where this vote is that they can ditch on somebody. And it's a blame game. It's a totally different game than I've ever seen.
Now, do you think it's because they started with such a large number of house guests that there was like so many votes that you could really... But it was 9-4. Who was the four? Who was the
right? And the MVP has thrown a big old wrench in it. You know, I thought it would be kind of neat how to do that, because with three people up, there's less room to hide. You're not going to have any floaters. Well, it hasn't. I don't know that it served that purpose at all. I think all it has done is forced them to play faster, more ridiculous, run around in circles. I mean, they're putting powers in the house that aren't even close to being in there yet, if they ever got them. Right now, they're at the amount of people that most seasons start with, and they're talking about jury.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they're already talking about who's going to make jury and who deserves it. I love the talk about, do you deserve it? You don't deserve to be here. You don't. I'm like, do any of you guys deserve to? I think that's so funny when they say it. You know, you hear him outside talking. Yeah, he doesn't deserve to be on jury. I just want to knock on the screen and go, jury, folks, if you're in jury, you're a loser. You've lost. Nobody wants to be there.
Yeah.
But they're all happy to get it, and that's the other thing about being young. The way they look at it is they figure, hey, I get paid if I go to jury.
Yeah.
It's free money.
I get 5 more weeks of vacation. I don't have to go home.
I get 5 more weeks of vacay and watching girls in bikinis for Spencer. I mean, that I won't even go into what I think of that guy. I get a creepy feeling when I see him on the screen.
All right, so...
Sorry.
No, we'll talk more about Spencer in a little bit here. So... Aaron is the HOH, and we were worried about this on Thursday. You know what that means, Shelley. It's the return of Clowney.
That thing's terrible.
Yeah.
And they leave him on screens on the live feed at night. So if you're like me and you go to sleep with your live feeds on and you wake up and there's that clown in that green light, and you're like, ah, it's either that or this morning, honestly, I got awakened by McCray and McManda. I mean, it was 6 o'clock in the morning, and I hear... Slurpy derpy, and I was like, whoa. I wake up and I'm like, no, too early for this stuff. And then there's that clown.
Yeah.
So don't sleep with your feeds on.
Well, you're used to all these showmances. I mean, you played on a season with Brendan and Rachel and Jeff and Jordan and Danny and Dominico, but they weren't, they had the decency to wait until they got out of the house to be.
And so did Jeff and Jordan. They were very classy about it.
These
people, they all must have taken, I don't know, some kind of horn dog. And I'm being kind of facetious there, but they got to figure out what makes Aaron tick. And what makes Aaron tick is making her feel like, Aaron, you really are a good person. Aaron, everybody kind of sees you wrong, and I want to help people see you right. So show people that you can keep a secret. Show people that you can play this game. Let's get together and go do it. And nobody will expect that you and I are working together, Spencer and Aaron. You know, and I think it may never work. I mean, sometimes they don't, but you got to go in and do more than, well, I just wanted you to hear my story, and, you know, I think we can do this. That's not going to get you anywhere. If you don't want to go home, you got to make big moves, and right now they're all so skittish that you could make up any lie and probably stay. But you got to be willing to lie. And I obviously was.
Oh, Shelley, you're putting on like a master's class tonight.
No, not at all.
Fantastic.
Not at all.
Go in those
strategy rooms, and those people have awesome ideas. I mean, I wish all those people would go out, BB strategy room and stuff, and they would try out for Big Brother, because they really think through the game. I'm sure, Brian, you get it. When you watch some of the chat, they really get the game, and they follow everything. I mean, watching people follow Judd's strategy. Some people think Judd doesn't know what he's doing. Judd is really good about what he puts out there and what he doesn't put out there. Very good social. And he's kind of got an out because he agrees to what everybody says. His strategy is agree, agree, agree. And then he can back out of it whenever he wants. But he's very good at putting out the information that he wants, and I think McCray may be the only one figuring out that he's pretty smart. But I love that kid. I think he is just a doll baby. I do. I think he's funny.
Okay. And you would you wear a bear shirt like Judd has?
Absolutely, I would in a heartbeat. In a heartbeat. He's a doll. I just like, you know why I think he's so genuine, and at times I don't even know if he realizes he's as good as he is. I think it's very just him. I mean, the way that he talks to people is really cute. I just think he's a neat young man.
So we also had our have-have-not competition for tonight. I thought it was kind of a boring have-have-not. It was a rather forgettable have-have-not, ironically.
Yeah.
Where we had basically, we combined my least favorite thing, the have-have-not competition, with some product placement for the new season of Unforgettable coming to CBS next week.
That's right.
I thought it was a hard game also to remember where you put all those things, right?
Oh, I mean, anybody that goes in there to do that game, they're all grabbing it as quick as they can. Nobody stays there and looks at it. And now the next guests that go into the house next season, when they have a challenge like that, somebody will be sitting there memorizing the shelf, and they'll mess it up for you again. You know, you don't think about that way. I thought it was really funny how the different groups approached the challenge.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if it was editing or what, but it looked like some of them just like went one by one by one to grab things and throw it on the table, and the rest of them brought it all over and stacked it up, which was pretty smart. So you could see the sizes and everything, but hey, the outfits were cute. And it was funny to watch. I got to give Gina Marie credit. She is good funny on TV with her just, I got to do my blonde thing now, and she had no clue. I mean, I think it's funny. I mean, I think her, I don't even know if you call it vocabulary that she uses, but it cracks me up. There are times that I laugh out loud when I hear that girl talk. She's just so goofy.
Her compromisation.
Compromisation and just all the little words she makes up, and then watching her put down yogurt. I've never seen anything like that in my entire life.
No, never. Ever. Nobody has.
And she, if you weren't a live feeder, go online. You can watch her do a cinnamon challenge. Never in my life have I seen anything like that.
What's the cinnamon challenge?
They went and had they did it in our season too. Brendan and Rachel put cinnamon in their mouth, and you put a teaspoon in, and you can't swallow it. And like Brendan looked like Puff the Magic Dragon. It was so cute, but it goes up in your nose, and they're spitting and throwing up, and it's gross. Well, so Judd and Aaron decided to do it outside, and they put it in, and they were spitting, and it was, I mean, Aaron started choking and gagging right away. Judd too. Well, then Gina, of course, in her kind of tough way, said, "Bring it. Bring it, bro. Bring it. Okay, bro?" So she takes this big old teaspoon of cinnamon, pops it in her mouth. Now, nobody goes more than about 10 seconds, and it's flying out. And she goes, "Bring it!" And she gets it down. I've never seen anybody get it down. And then she did it again.
Whoa.
And then she wanted to do the milk challenge, and I was like, that girl, there's just something different going on with her whole throat, nose, swallowing. I don't know how she did it, because you can go watch that online, Cinnamon Challenge, and nobody gets it down, and she killed it. It was amazing.
All right.
And it's just funny. She has that tough. It really Brooklyn tough, but I'm sure all the pageant people were like, oh, my Lord, that's our pageant girl. I'm sure they've said that several times. And I don't even know what pageant girls do, but I can only see that their pageant poor people are probably like, that's our girl.
Hey, you know, look, what's the big deal? I got to eat some cinnamon. That's what I do for my special talent in the beauty competition. I eat cinnamon. I eat anything.
You do a great accent. That accent is so funny. And the way that she does it is always like, you know, people would always tease me. When I went back and watched the feeds, people would always say, oh, just awful things about, but I mean, she talk about talking like a man. She's like, "Well, yeah, dope, bro, hip, pull, pull, pull," popping things and scrapping things, and I'm like, "Wow!" But the accent that you do, it is funny when she does that, and just I will never forget the cockroaches. And then one time she said something, I was laughing so hard. She's like, let's blow this popsicle stand or something. And I'm like, wait, don't you want to stay? Why are you saying you want to get out? You know, she's like, yeah, but that's when she got really mad. She's like, blow this popsicle stand. I'm like, no, you want to stay.
Yeah.
But she doesn't know how to place her little, it's kind of funny, but there is an endearing part of her too. Her mouth is just filthy. Filthy.
Yes.
There's a number of reasons. Games online for the language that they use. They always, our strategy room, they do drinking games all the time where if they say like or don't tell anybody or the not so nice word. So it's funny to watch people do that because it lets you enjoy the show.
So after Have Not, we had a very interesting part of the show. I think maybe the most interesting part of the entire episode was the Howard and Candace stuff, because I was a little confused about what Howard actually wanted. So he sets up Candace. He tells Candace that she needs to go talk to Aaron. And mm-hmm. he says basically, he's, you know, as you mentioned earlier, one of his speeches, a little circular perhaps, that he says to Candace, he's like, and he's very soft-spoken. He's like, you know when I told you that you had to go and hold back? He's like, now's the time. You need to go get your bed back. And I'm like, okay.
I didn't get that.
Yeah, go get your bed back. And so he sends in Candace to go talk to Aaron, and Aaron says she has a Candace switch, which allows her to just block her out. And Candace comes back dejected and very upset with Howard, feeling like that Howard set her up mm-hmm. to be a target here. And so it's a two-part question here. Number one, what was Howard's agenda? What did he want? And is Candace right to feel this way?
I'm with you. I have no idea what he wanted, and I didn't understand it. And I think it was some really, like, positive attitude speech, like, go get your bed back, go take back your name, go get it, and go get it from Aaron. And at the same time where it seemed like back and all that, he didn't want her to suck up to her. It seemed like now he was asking her to suck up to somebody that had hurt her. And she wanted to do it for him, because she obviously cares about him, and she went up there and did it and got nothing in return.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. And honestly, in watching that exchange, you knew that Candace was obviously putting a bigger target on her back, that Aaron was coming out of it going, you know what, you both can go. And so I think she came down dejected because she didn't get this real positive reaction from Aaron, like, I really do want Howard to stay. I think it was very contrived, and she felt it. And I think still, Candace says she forgives and she forgets. I still think it's very difficult for her to go and talk face-to-face with her. I don't think she likes her. And I think she felt like Howard was putting her up there to do his game. And if he wanted to go make his speech to save himself, he needs to go do it himself. You know, it was probably, I can understand as women, we're emotional. Men are typically more visual. And I think he thought that she could go in there and make the emotional plea better than him. And so he maybe used her a little bit to get to that side. And she came back, and his first thing to her was, you know, how'd it go? Not, how are you doing? Mm-hmm. And a woman is more emotional. I think she was hurt by that. So it was odd. It was an odd ending. And I'm not sure where that story's going. I wonder if that story will peel into Wednesday, because it was a little bit confusing to me of where all of that is going, except for, you know, the nominations.
Brian, did you have a better read on that Candace, Howard, and Aaron discussion?
You know, I was left with the impression that he may have, you know, since it benefits him, that he may have wanted her to do that, but might not want to say it on the feeds or even express it in the diary room.